And then, well, I'll hit any questions as well, but I figured, I'll probably start with, like, you know, what are your guys' biggest, what's your biggest gripe if you had to pick one? And Robert, I feel like you started to hit on that with, like, one of your first questions where it was, kind of like, pick up the phone, for example, that might be your biggest, gripe. And so Jennifer, if you can just brainstorm on, like, what a big gripe of yours is where you're like, man, we could be so much better for clients if X, Y, or Z, if they just did X, Y, or Z.
Interesting. Okay. Yeah. That's a good one. I'll follow Robert's lead. That's where I'm most comfortable anyway.
So it's funny because the original title was the 10 things that vendors hate about you, management companies, and why you need to know it.
Oh my God. That's so much different. That's hilarious.
But agreeably, David kind of softened it up a little bit, but it's not so much a bitch fest. It's just a matter of, hey, you guys do some things over and over again and you just stop because we can help you if you do the following, right? So it's constructive in nature.
Yeah. So, I don't think, at least the audience that, the folks here that are Digible audience that are listening, they will know that, like, we're pretty, it's not to be gripey, obviously, yeah. Robert, but it's also one of those things I kind of like was pitching this internally, like, as if, there's going to be one more, Jude from Flamingo. He's going to get on, but I haven't met Jude before, but anyways, more like if the four of us met at like a happy hour and we were just talking about like, man, if wouldn't X, Y, or Z go better if management companies just did that. So that's kind of the angle I was thinking about it.
Yep. Yeah. I like it. Fly on the wall in the conversation.
Yeah, exactly.
Cool. So, you're going to, this is a podcast, you're going to put this out, or how are you guys promoting?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's going to get cut up into, each session's going to get cut up and put on YouTube, and then we can send you guys copies if you want to do anything you want to do with it.
Yeah, we'll promote it. We always try to push out that stuff on our stuff too.
Cool.
Sure. We can do that.
So, for any other questions, how do we make you less nervous? Do you want me to send some other like Applewood liquors over to your office or something?
Perfect. Could you do that real quick? I mean, I'm so close. We're very, Robert, I'm like down the street from Digible.
Are you really? Mm-hmm. Oh, that's funny. I didn't know that.
We haven't ever actually had Jen by the office. So that would be.
I went to the old office, but I just noticed that you moved because I drove by the building and saw the sign.
We have a sign though.
Don't you have a sign
outside? I know we're getting a sign installed. I didn't know if it was finished yet. That's
or like on the window or something.
Okay. Yeah.
Jen spray painted on there for you.
Yeah. We've had the last week we've had sign guys out here like installing. So I was like, shoot, did it actually go up? And I didn't notice. But it's going to be, you know, lighted, hanging off the building, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But you got to come by, Jennifer. We got to have you. You know, it's been a while.
Yes, I agree. Let's do it.
And Jen's a cool cat too. She's been doing speaking for years, so she's always very comfortable in front of a crowd.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was.
I have some experience speaking. Yeah,
that was one of her primary roles back in apartment guide days, getting up and wowing the crowds.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So, Jen, were you at apartment guide before you went to what Ingrain, and then before Pynwheel? How it worked?
Yes. Yep. Exactly.
I didn't have your LinkedIn up, so I was just trying to piece it together.
Yes, I did consulting with a company called Multifamily Edge that then I merged with a company called Creativity for Rent to form Ingrain. So I did, mm-hmm. So it was like Multifamily Edge for a couple years, and I did consulting for some PMCs like Aimco and what is that one? And I don't know. I can't remember the name of it, but, and also like apartment lists and Oodle and Vast and some other companies that are
Oodle.
Do you remember Oodle?
Oh yeah. That's a name I haven't heard for a while.
Craig Donato. And they did Facebook Marketplace.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Crazy. Nicole Staley, that's guessing that there's a, that's right. There's a relationship there.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow there's a
She's a founder and my wife.
Yeah, there
you go. And we have a kiddo on the way. So
no way! Congratulations.
What? Thanks. Yeah, I'm guessing 5 weeks because we're due the 11th, but we just got another ultrasound yesterday, right. And they have a 96th percentile for size. So
oh my gosh, you guys are so close. To be the case
when we're at 9,000 feet, but so be it.
This is your first one, right?
First.
Okay. Yeah. The I always tell people you're gonna first 3 weeks panic, and they're like, I'm never sleeping again. And then the fourth week you actually try sleeping again.
Okay.
Everyone's like, oh my god, I'm never sleeping again. And then you do. So there's a light at the end of that tunnel.
Yeah. Maybe I should be more worried than I am, but I'm not worried.
You handle like a pro. Jen, you've got like 6 kids, don't you?
17. I have 17 children.
17. Nice. Like the mother in the shoe.
I only have 2.
That's right.
And they're 14 and 16 now, if you can believe that.
Wow.
So they're fun. They're easy.
Remember when you first told me you were with your first?
That was
Scottsdale, Arizona.
Crazy? I remember that moment too. You were like, I know.
I knew. I could tell. You had a glow.
Skinny girls can't hide it.
Do we have Jude's contact info to see if...
Yeah, I can reach out to him.
Making sure that he makes his way here.
Yeah, I've got his mobile number if you need it. Has everyone got it?
Erica, do you have Jude's number? No. Robert says he has it if you need it.
Got his mobile. He and I hung out in Chicago for a while. So I've got his number here. If you want it, it's 443-682-3180.
Jennifer, if you didn't get that.
Oh, okay. I see him in the waiting room right now.
Oh, he's here. All right. Thanks, Robert.
Yeah, no problem.
He would just had to think very hard.
Yeah.
And then
conjured him forward. Yeah, we hung out in the red velvet something or other in Chicago. It's a speakeasy, like a 1920s mixology speakeasy place. It was fun.
Oh, that sounds cool.
Yeah. Hey, here he is.
Hey, guys. Hey, sorry, I am a little bit late. I had something that went way over.
That's all right. Everyone's in the waiting room, the breakout rooms right now. Well, this is more like the backstage, if you would. So, you know, Robert, it sounds like you guys hung out. Have you met Jen before?
I have not.
No, nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you officially.
So, Jen's from Pynwheel. I guess we'll do introductions on the thing. But Jude, what we just got to beforehand was we're going to treat this was originally Robert's idea. We're going to treat this kind of like, almost like the four of us were at happy hour. And we're just talking like, man, wouldn't it be nice if customers just did X, Y, or Z, that kind of angle. That way, you know, more so, like give them more insight, how to better leverage their vendors, how to better work with them. I think Robert, he added some notes into the doc that I had started.
Yeah, I did see that.
Great. Yeah. Because I think like he makes a good point. Like a lot of times I feel like as a vendor, you can almost be like a second tier citizen or something where they're like, I don't need to answer your phone call. Yeah. Or I don't need to like respond to your email. It's like, that just makes it not perform well, you know, whatever service you're providing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's very true.
Any other questions, Jude, or anything else you want to get to us before, you know, we go on air?
Yeah, so it's going to be Jennifer, Robert, and I. And then I see a few other people, or are those the people in the breakout rooms?
Yeah, I'll be there too. These are just folks on the Digible team that were here for different things.
So. Oh, got it. Okay, cool.
So they don't get moved in the breakout room, so we're not like pitching people.
And then how long is the session going to go on for? I know on my calendar it shows like an hour.
Yep. Yep. We'll do probably like however long our conversation goes, let's say 45 minutes or so, and then we can take some questions the last 15. Okay. There have been some sessions that people are pretty active and then some where they're not the participants. So I think it's fair, like if we don't see a ton of questions coming through, we can all ask each other questions. Like I should, obviously, I think that would be more interesting anyways, if it's more conversational between the four of us versus whatever, Robert on a soapbox.
No, Robert, yeah. I'm going to join you on that soapbox. I read through what you said and I have my own notes, but no, you are exactly right.
Yeah. It's, hey, it's like any industry, but multifamily is like a family. We'll get into the details, but I mean, we got to kind of treat each other with some, and there's some great people in our industry. And there's some pros, like really great people, but others kind of take them for granted. Sometimes they're supplier, vendors, partners. Mm-hmm. We'll dive into it. If I push the envelope too far, you can edit it out, right?
Not a chance.
Oh, nice. Not a
chance to push too far, but also not a chance there's any editing on our side.
It's like, don't get the impression we're going to edit any of this.
Yeah, right. I was trying to listen to one of the podcasts we did the other day. Like I always hit record, and Reed was telling me some story about his underwear. And I was like, I actually don't know if that will get cut out or not. So that's... I don't know if Erica's still here. So Erica, if there's a, you may hear before the Welcome to Digible Dudes, Reed's telling a story about his underwear.
Oh my gosh, that's gold. You should not edit stuff like that out.
I know.
You should lead with that.
That's hilarious.
Okay, I think we're ready to bring everyone back and get started.
Cool.
So I'll play some tunes until everyone's here. Okay. Like 30 seconds, and then we'll start. What can I say about me? I'm here to let you know that I'm doing fine. 360 degrees. I mean, I just ate an apple pie. And I try my best to keep it real with you tonight. I feel good. I'm on my good foot, baby. I'm gonna do my
best. And then Robert, I don't know who's supposed to be quiet or talking, but the speakeasy was Violet Hour.
Violet Hour, that's it.
Yeah, that was the name. Yeah.
That was fun.
Definitely
go back.
Yeah, it's definitely like one of my favorite places in Chicago. I think I went once this summer, but haven't really gone back.
No, we had a good time.
Told the folks. And the last time prior to that was when you and I were there. So.
Okay.
It's a sad favorite place that I don't go to as frequently as I need to.
You live in Chicago, June?
Yeah, I'm in Chicago, yep.
Nice.
I think we got everyone back from the breakout rooms, and I can see the conversations have already started. So I'll give you the cue for officially starting the session now.
Yeah, thanks, Jan. Well, we're here for the panel session. I don't usually lead panel sessions, so feel special. This might be the first panel I've done. Usually that's Reed's move, folks. But anyways... we've got Jennifer Cyphers, Robert Turnbill, and Jude. Oh, shoot, Jude, I didn't even get your last name. Chi. All right, thanks, Jude. Well, Jude, why don't you kick off, introduce yourself, and then we'll go reverse order to Robert and then Jen.
Okay, excellent. So my name is Jude, and I am the founder and CEO of Flamingo. So Flamingo offers the one-app resident journey. We kind of bring everything residents need into one place. So unique perspective, because we work both with the on-site teams, the regionals, the corporate teams, IT, but then we also work with a lot of other vendors in the industry because we have to integrate with various systems. So get to see how everyone from the corporate side to the vendor side kind of works with their partners.
Cool. Robert?
Yeah, Robert Turnbull, BetterBot, president and founder. I've been in multifamily for 23 years now. I got out for 3 years. That's the limit. Then you're required to come back after 3 years. So I've got a storied history. BetterBot basically is a digital leasing agent. So we try to replicate your best leasing agent and help you with some of the repetitive, mundane stuff and get that off your table so your people can be people with other people. that's the short version.
I'm Jennifer Cyphers. I'm the founder and CEO of Pynwheel. Pynwheel does touchscreen applications and mobile applications for on-site leasing, as well as interactive maps. And I also have been in the industry for 23 years. It's a long time. Unreal. I didn't realize it had been that long until you said that. I was like, wow, I've been in the industry for 23 years.
Yeah. Only I look like it. You don't look like it. That annoys me.
Thank you. I was two when I started. So
yeah, clearly.
That mean that you ever were out? Do you even know how good you have it?
What's that?
You even know how good you have it here in multifamily, or have you been to any other industries?
I have been in other industries, like in a way, like working for companies where I still was involved in multifamily, but the companies were also involved in autos and for sale real estate and that kind of thing. So,
okay.
But multifamily is like such its own, I mean, you can't, like Robert said, like you get sucked in and you can't get out because it's its own little universe here. And once you know it, it's just great.
Mm-hmm. Well, this originally I mentioned now backstage, and now we'll mention on stage. This was Robert's idea. I love the idea, but I was calling this more like a kitchen confidential for on the vendor side of multifamily. And we were just saying, let's treat this more like a conversation, as if the four of us are at happy hour and just saying, man, you know, if only our clients knew this, you know, we could do such a better job. So anyways, I know, Robert, I'll let you do your kickoff as far as meaning what is your number one thing that you're like, man, how come you just want to like shake someone's shoulders, you know, because they could be using you better.
Yeah. And so look, I want to make sure this is very constructive. There's some things that drive management companies a little crazy about vendors sometimes, and vendors that drive, you know, get driven crazy by some things management companies do. But I think it's really important that we put it out there and so we can work through it. Look, I'll just go ahead and throw it out there right now. I think, and I've been in other industries, and multifamily, it's kind of an odd one. It's a family, first of all, so we're very familiar with each other. But often vendors or suppliers get treated a little bit like second-class citizens, where, you know, let me reschedule for the fifth time on last minute notice, not return emails, not return phone calls, especially when you're doing business with them. So, you know, vendors, and they're really actually looking to do a better job, get feedback, have open communication. And when that gets shut down, it's not good for anybody. And you see that kind of pervasively play out. And you have, look, you've got some folks that are fantastic pros in our industry, and you've got others that not so much. And I think they're hurting themselves. So I'm just going to start with that, and we can kind of unpack that as we go. But I'll throw that first one out.
Yeah, and I think that's a really important point that you mentioned, that this, something like this is more like, how do we help each other? It's not, let's kind of pound on like a dead horse. So surface the issues that like we see from our end and kind of talk through where they can be things that are just like done a lot better. So definitely agree on your end, Robert, that it really is like a very, very important topic, especially as the industry continues to grow and relies more on whether it's technology or relies more on strategic partners to really get their goals like met. And the only way to do that is by really optimizing how they work with their like suppliers. I know for external to the industry, one of the really best practices that you see is a lot of, in different industries, a lot of companies have, whether it's like a procurement department or something else that really specializes in working with external firms so that they get the same level of professionalism that they might get anywhere else.
And Jude, what would be your pet peeve? I know you've been doing Flamingo for a number of years now. It's transitioned into a couple from prior companies, my understanding, to Flamingo now, but you must have gathered something along the way. And I also remember one of the fun facts I heard about you was that you had knocked on like, you spent like 5 months just like knocking on doors and talking to property managers. So just trying to set you up, you've done a lot of user engagement, testing, surveying, you know, through that process. Do you have any pet peeves that have hit you?
Yeah, absolutely. So you are right on that. Actually spent 5 months where I went to every like large apartment in Chicago. So from like 8 to 5, walked from door to door, spoke with the residents, the on-site teams, front desk, like whoever. So really got to learn. That was my education for the industry, to really learn how it like functions. I would say for me, my biggest pet peeve is lack of decision making. So one of the key things I see in the industry is that a lot of people are not really empowered to make decisions. And then a lot of people that are empowered don't make the decisions when they need to. So you have things that kind of drag on. So a lot of times I'm like, I would want to hear the no. Like, if this isn't something that makes sense for you, say no. Don't kind of ignore the email or the call or respond like 10 weeks later. It's like, hey, if this isn't the right time, just say it is. It's not. So I think a lot of people, I don't know if it's because everyone is afraid to hurt someone's feelings or what it is, but for most vendors or most partners, they want to hear a yes or no, or maybe not a right now. It's just much easier to say, hey, this doesn't make sense for us, and here are the reasons why.
Totally agree.
Yeah, it's like,
I love that one. Brown,
right? Brene Brown says, clear as kind. So Jennifer, you know, sorry, I was talking over you, so I was passing it to you, but go for it.
No, I totally agree with you. I think that that's a good one that I wouldn't have thought of, is that I do feel like people are conflict averse, and actually saying no to a vendor is much kinder than not saying yes or no. And then even to take it a step further, it's actually really helpful to me, probably to you guys too, if people say no, and this is why. No, we're making changes, that's fine. No, we prefer this other vendor, and this is why they're a better match for our company, even better. It's like very helpful to get that information. So it's actually much kinder to go about things that way.
We've had a couple companies over the years, last couple of years in particular, who actually picked us, and they told us specifically why they picked us. Mm-hmm. We've had a couple that didn't, and they were very specific on a post as to, hey, would you mind learning more? I'm like, not only yes, but let me get the whole team on. Like, we want to hear that. So we're okay with the no. And I think you're right. There's this fear that you're going to offend somebody. You know, we're all grown-ups here. Yeah. We can hear a no. We just need to know it's a no, and why it would be very helpful, and we can move on.
Totally agree. I think the why is definitely very helpful. And I think part of this too is it's a small industry, but it's also a large industry. So I think part of the reasons why someone might be afraid to say no is not only because they think they might hurt your feelings, but they think, oh man, that's the end of everything. It's like, no, if you say no, there are hundreds of other apartments out there for us, or potential customers for us to work with. You're not the only one. It's just like, hey, you are one of 100 people that I'm talking to as well too.
Yeah, and that kind of goes along with what I was going to say about my biggest pet peeve is when I work with vendors, I look at my vendors as partners, and I love it when our clients look at us as a partner. And it's kind of that level of respect too. If they choose not to partner with us, that's fine. Like you said, there are other companies that it is the right fit. It's nice for them to just make that decision. And when we do have a relationship with clients, I think that mutual respect goes a really, really long way.
I'm going to flip the script for just a second too, because we're talking about getting feedback as vendors. I think one of the things, for the most part, and this is what I'm going to say, not everybody, for the most part, a lot of management companies do not take feedback well. It was an absolutely botched rollout. So there's this assumption that it was a supplier, and actually that's simply not true. There's some processes and broken. And funny thing is, suppliers often sit back and then they see a process. They actually see broken processes along the way. They're like, oh my gosh, their communication is terrible. This hand doesn't know what this hand's doing. And there are several times when there's people I feel comfortable enough to say, hey, do you mind if I kind of give you a little bit of feedback? Because we're so used to the vendor being the one who blew it, and then the management company being in the driver's seat, that's actually, you're not doing yourself any favors. You really, I think management companies need to open themselves up and get feedback from the vendors, because they might be solving some problems they didn't even know they had.
Yeah.
So when I'm comfortable, I'll and I think they're comfortable, I'll offer the feedback. Otherwise, I just keep my mouth shut.
That is such a great, sorry, Jennifer, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, that is such a great point, Robert, because from the vendor side, you have a very unique insight into a lot of things. So one of my big observations is exactly that. You see what companies really have their processes, procedures, and everything together, and the ones that do not. And all in so many situations, I want to broach that topic to say, hey, this, you guys just don't know how to do this. Like, here's how X, Y, and Z like does it. If you did the same thing, your processes and your business would be drastically different, because it's so clear when there is no communication. Oh, like you said, the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. I've come across that so many times, and it puts so many things at risk, whether it's an implementation or whether it's something really, really critical to the business.
Have you guys tried I say, just because Jennifer said it, Jennifer, sometimes I hate the word partner, because it's like, there are companies, vendors that we work with that do act like a partner, and then there are some where they treat it very transactional. But I'm just going to ask you guys, have you guys tried or found any success with almost like using consultants to help with that? Because I'll say this is something recent for me, but there are oftentimes, as you guys mentioned, that we start to do some marketing for someone or some implementation. And then through that, it's like, man, they really need to clean up X, Y, and Z. And only recently did I start recommending like consultants along the way. I'd be like, you know what, you should really talk to so-and-so, because I think they could really help you fix this thing. And I'm like 12 weeks into that experiment, and it's worked really well for me, because otherwise I find a lot of management companies may be like, hey, could you basically do this for me? And it becomes more as if like we're a free outsource consultant, which we do like to provide a lot of added value, but then it's really hard to limit when how to like gracefully exit from that and say, hey, you know, now you really definitely need to get someone. So I just wonder if you got, if any of the three of you have tried that before.
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah, I think that is a great idea. From our end, we haven't. And part of it is because the industry is like very like, but when I think consultants, and I think this applies to a lot of people, when you think consultant, you think something extremely expensive. So recommending to a company to spend more money is something that I kind of hesitate doing. For us, like what we have done more of is use that as an opportunity for a way to scale that advice that we want to provide. So for us, it turns into content. So right now we have a series of essays that we publish regularly called How Would X Run Your Apartment? And we use that to talk about like how different companies or how different industries would run an apartment building. And we use that to incorporate like the best practices that we see, whether it's, hey, this is how this company would utilize technology, or this is how this industry would do this type of process. So for us, it's using that as a way to scale advice in some ways. Excuse me.
Yeah. Jennifer, what is the number one thing that you could use when you're like onboarding a new client, as far as like them engaging with you or whatever, that will really muck things up? Because you have a lot of assets that you have to deal with for your business. So I just imagine there's something there with like asset handover or something, but is there something else that's more important?
No, we've actually gone through a lot of transitions since I first started Pynwheel, because that's the biggest challenge, is that at the beginning, we need, like you said, a lot of content assets. We're setting up a lot of integrations. And so there's a lot that we need from our clients. So when we started, we used to have weekly calls with our clients, and they would work on their stuff and we would work on our stuff. And it would take forever. And we always had clients that didn't get their stuff in. And then they would be like, wait, this has taken 16 weeks. And we're like, well, we still don't have your floor plans or whatever. And so then that transitioned to more structure in terms of processes. And now it's super streamlined and structured, where we have a dashboard that our clients are invited to, and they have to submit everything. They have to submit information for their integrations. They have to submit all of their content. Anybody on their side can log in and see what's been submitted and what hasn't been submitted. And then after we have every single thing that we need, it goes into production. They get a notification that it's in production. Production always takes 2 to 4 weeks. We never vary from that timeline. And they don't hear from us during production. It's just like everything gets done and then they're notified when it's done. And it is unbelievable how much more efficient it has made us. The insight on their side is great, because they're much more motivated to get all their stuff done more quickly. It's just made like the biggest difference to just have it all kind of like, you do your thing and you all have insight into that. And once you're done, we'll do our thing. It takes a little bit of education at the beginning sometimes, because it's not how people in our industry are used to working. They're like, well, can't you just get started while we work on this? No, we're totally consistent about it because it's the only way that we have been able to remain consistent.
And Jennifer, have you tried to incentivize them? Meaning we've had discussions, like as we start to get into websites at Digible, we've had discussions like, should we start billing them up front? Meaning like their monthly charge so that it like helps push them to say, get the stuff to us. Cause we've had some of our early clients where it takes them 12 weeks to get us the assets. And it's like, we could have built this in 5 days.
Yeah.
But also, and I'm gonna get Jennifer's answer and then use as a chance to move to Robert for billing. Cause I know you had some notes on billing, Robert, but have you ever tried anything like that, Jennifer, to incentivize them versus the like, well, shoot, I could see a higher up on your end of a customer being like, why is this taking, 12 or 16 weeks? And you're like, well, it's your team, to Robert's point before, like you just owed me this, but then it's not like they all of a sudden, like they still have that emotional feeling inside that they're frustrated with you, even if you're like, oh, and you pointed out that it's them. So now they're still ticked off.
We just have a client just recently who just got us their last piece of information for integration on September 9th. And they were like, well, we still want to go live on September 15th. And I was like, well, it's still going to be 2 to 4 weeks from September 9th. And that's, and as long as we're consistent, even though they get frustrated, as long as we're consistent, as long as we deliver within those timelines, it's okay. We have not gone to billing them upfront for the subscription, but the only reason is because we work with a lot of like renovations, new construction. And so sometimes the timing isn't right. Like, just because of construction delays, things like that, we've talked about it. We try to be really considerate in terms of what's affecting their timing. That's kind of outside of the PMC's direct control. But that might be motivational for them to get stuff done. Our perspective right now is like, if it takes you 16 weeks to submit your content, it takes you 16 weeks. It's still going to take us 2 to 4 weeks to do production. And that's kind of like on you,
Robert.
Well, I have a couple thoughts on the billing. I try to frame things in a way that a lot of management companies will understand because they have renters. So you deliver said product and you deliver it at a certain time, and then maybe they didn't implement until a month or two down the road, so they don't want to pay for it. We're like, well, funny, someone signed a lease on June 1, but they didn't move into August. You don't charge them for the 2 months that they didn't live there, right? Well, of course we charge them. Of course you do. So if we delivered the product and we had it here, why would we not be charging and start the clock? The other thing is, and again, using the renter analogy, can we pay net 60, 90 days? So do you charge people in March and April for your January rent, or do you charge them in January? And we all got to pay our bills. So, I mean, put that in perspective. Why would your business, you need cash flow, you have all these things, deliverables and costs. So why would that be any different for your suppliers or vendors? So I think that's just a courtesy to recognize that, hey, we've got things we got to cover too, and we have deadlines we need to hit and resources we have to pay. So when you put it in that framework where I think they understand, it actually does make sense. I try to do it funny in a kind of a humorous way, but they get it usually. And, we're all running our own businesses.
Yeah. And I love that. Mine off on that point as well. For me, I think one of the biggest sticking points has been like contracts. Like everyone wants the 30 day out or the month to month. And we've had to say no. And we use the same analogy, Robert, that you use, which is, are your residents on a month to month? Do they sign a lease? Can they get a 30 day and move out without any penalties? It's like, no.
Yeah.
Same thing for us too. We can't have that.
Well, and I'll talk about the downstream impact, if you will. So I'm with you guys, like you want it to feel fair to the client, right? So you want to hit it up front. But at the same time, a lot of times clients will be like, well, Robert, how much does it really cost you? Like those 2 months that my property wasn't open, or Jennifer, like, I didn't give you the assets, so it didn't cost you anything, right? Or like the tech costs are low. But a lot of the tech, the integration work requires human hours, right, to get done. Yep. And so it's for us, when we get an order, we have to now budget our time and staff around that. So some new person puts an order, let's pretend integration setup was 5 hours or something. We have to then like earmark 5 hours so that we can meet those SLAs. So Jennifer, to your point about having 2 weeks to launch, you've got to earmark a certain amount of time for your folks to get the stuff built. And if someone basically it's not like you have rollover minutes with your staff where you can now wait till like use those next month, those rollover hours. Instead, you are budgeting this month so you can hit your SLAs. So that's why, as a, I guess I'm trying to make the point, like why you can't just say, no, we won't charge you until it's time. A lot of times you're reserving human hours. If you had 10 properties that were reserving 5 human hours each, that's a whole week that you're setting, that we're setting aside for an engineer. And that's rather expensive. So Robert, I think you also had another note that I thought was really interesting about driving up costs by some of this behavior. And that's one of those things that if we don't charge for that time, meaning start the subscription, it inflates our costs of human labor that we now have to cover, which then at some point gets passed along down to the industry, right? That if I've now got to have an engineer on standby, it drives up what we end up having to charge for the end product.
Yeah. No, I think that's well stated. But
well, and then the 60 to 90 day terms, I think is really interesting because, which you had briefly brought up, Robert, because for us, we have some, for our tech product, it's not as big of a cost of goods besides that human labor we're setting aside. But if we're paying media costs for somebody like their Google spend, and now we're, you know, they're paying 90 days later, that is a massive, you know, thing. So in the early days of Digible, that almost crushed us. Cash flow was just almost impossible because we were growing, you know, double digit percentage every month. And then we frankly had 60 day terms. And so people weren't paying for on average like 56 days for us. And that made it so it's like, well, we can't actually take on new properties of yours, Mr. Customer, because we are still covering the cost for you for 2 months ago and you haven't paid. Or someone will sign like a 30 day pay, but then they'll pay it 60 days to help stretch out accounts receivable, which has the same impact. We went through a big initiative internally about maybe 24 months ago that really helped. And we got that average pay time down from 56 days to something like 22 days just by talking to our customers. So we went to them and we're just really authentic. That's one of our core values and said, hey, here's the impact. Like we really, you know, for us to be able to launch campaigns on a dime and give you guys month to month terms, we need, you know, we basically need you guys to pay within 30 days. If you don't, we can't like let you keep flexing your budget all the time because of what we have to carry. So anyways, that just worked for us. I don't, but if anybody has any comments, cool. If not, we can move to the next point.
No, that's a good point. I think people paying on time is, I also, same thing with our vendors. We pay on time all the time. And that makes our vendor partnerships super strong. So when I call the vendor and I'm like, I need you to drop what you're doing and help me, they drop what they're doing and help us because we always pay on time. And that's always important in a partnership.
Yeah.
One thing that does drive up costs, I don't know, David, if this is where we're going to go with the next one, is the sponsoring meetings and events.
Yeah, we actually have some folks that have worked that into their contract with us. They're like, oh, we're going to sign this agreement, but now you have to spend $22,000 at our event.
Yeah. So I don't know when that started. It feels like it was around 12 years ago. I'm like, kind of feel like 12 was the number. And a few companies did that. And I think other companies go, hey, they're onto something. So we'll do it too. And I really don't mind. There are some companies that are such great partners and they do business with us. I jump at the chance to sponsor them because they're on time. They provide so much value. I call it the bear hug. Like I just want to give you a big bear hug. And if it means being at an event and sponsoring something, absolutely. Where I get a little perturbed is when they have zero intent of either growing your business, but they'll take your money because they want to offset their costs, or they have you go to an event where you never see anybody. You're relegated to a back room somewhere where none of the decision makers are coming in. You're not included in any of the events, but they're there to take your check. That's not good business. That's just not a good business practice. There are a few companies that do that. And you give them feedback and say, hey, you know, this is what happened. Can you help it on the next one? You never hear anything back from them. They never improve it, but they keep sending you emails that you can sponsor them. So why is that how do you make this constructive? First of all, we actually could solve a problem for you. So you really do need to get some decision makers in there so they can make their own decision. If they're not hearing what you have to offer, you actually could be putting them in a situation where they don't know you may have a product could solve the problem they have. And again, it's just not great practice to take money and then not to provide any kind of a feedback or service back to the client. So they're to the vendor. Mm-hmm. So anyway, in summary, it's Yes, if you have an intention to work with that company, then offer that. But if you really don't have a plan or an intention, then that's just not a good business practice to take the money.
Well, I'll bring it back around to a prior point you made about wanting feedback. So, back to being constructive, we've had folks where they're like, hey, come sponsor our event. It's going to start on Tuesday and you need to be there for happy hour. But then we're going to have your vendor trade show or something on Thursday. And it's like, well, now, and there's nothing in between. So now we've got to, on our side, when we fly someone out there, we have to pay for extra hotel rooms, right? Like Monday night, like, mm-hmm. and then Tuesday, Wednesday, then do Thursday. So it's not helpful to spread, because then obviously back to driving up costs, that's less that we can actually pay your sponsorship, if you would, right? Because now we're doing the travel. Right. But back to constructive, I don't, a lot of vendors that I know, you guys included, they don't love to just go and hawk their wares, right? In this industry, and one reason I love this industry is because it's way more, it feels way more constructive, at least now in the last couple of years than it did like maybe 6-7 years ago when I got in. But a lot of the vendors don't want to just like, you know, jump on you like a carnivore. So like the trade show, I understand why they do that. But Robert, you were mentioning how much you guys want feedback for your product, or, you know, and I know that Jen and Jude were nodding to it. So instead, why not have it like, hey, vendor, could you sponsor this? Because of that, we're going to give you 30 minutes for you to get feedback on your product, like what's going well and what's not going well. I would value that far more than I would value a trade show. Or like, we'll let you do a survey and we, you know, we promise we'll get at least 100 people to respond to the survey of your choice. Again, that's way more value for me versus bringing a booth and just trying to, you know, struggle you to the ground.
That's a great idea. And that's material that you can get back to your team.
Yeah, really important point. And then talking about like partnerships, just being cognizant of the fact that the vendor is coming and is spending time and is spending money to sponsor that event. So making sure that you really view that as a partnership, so that afterwards you actually reach out to those vendors to understand if they actually got value from that sponsorship and how it can be done better. We have sponsored, I'll say, quite a few. And for some of them, it just like wasn't really that valuable for us. But there was no mechanism in place for them to know that outside of us like proactively telling them, like, hey, that was a waste of time for us.
Or not going the next year.
Yeah, exactly.
I also think it's really most impactful on smaller companies, startup companies, which are going to be more innovative companies. So if you're just trying to offset your costs for your annual meeting and you get some of the bigger companies, if you already your RealPage or whatever sponsors it, fine, and they can offset your costs. But when you have smaller companies or younger companies or more innovative companies that are looking at like, what is our ROI on this $5,000 here and this $7,000 here or $2,000 here, then those are the companies that are you're not going to get at your events. And then you're not getting the benefit of getting the information from those companies that are more likely to be more innovative, more likely to have new features every time you see them, more likely to have, I think, probably more and better information for your employees.
Yeah, and that are willing to maybe be more nimble for your needs, right? So if you're exactly. a management company, you want to, whatever, you want a feature update from Yardi, that's hard to get done, right? But from, you know, whatever, one of us, maybe it's easier to get done. We're just more nimble. And I remember the first time, Jude, I saw you was at, I think you were in some startup showcase. And I know that people really love when they go to like NAA or Optic or whatever, they love these like startup sections because mm-hmm. They're like, oh, I want to know what's new and cool. They don't want to, again, usually talk to Yardi or Intrada or whatever again. So that's just building on your idea, Jennifer. It's like maybe they, you know, a management company could have a Yardi or an Intrada be their key premier sponsor, but then when you could have an area where it's basically like, you know, we waive the fee for to have this startup section so that you as a management company, if your goal is to try to be forward thinking and, you know, like just more on top of like what's the trend, then you need those younger partners coming through, right?
That's a trend I really like that's been happening lately with the Optechs and the AIMS and the NAAs and a few others, where they're showcasing these startups. There are some wonderful technologies and products out there. They're really going to solve some problems. And so I love that they're doing that. Here's the issue. Once they get past that, the property management software companies have such a stranglehold on the data, and they want all this money that, you know, some of the bigger companies that can afford it, maybe we've gotten to a certain point where we can afford it, but it really kills innovation because some of these startups, they can't get the integration in place. So I've been saying for years, hey, look, recognize that they're a smaller company and get them in at a kind of a lower cost, or, you know, invest in that management. I don't want to name names, but property management software solution company, because that will help innovate in our industry. And something has got to happen. Something has got to break so the innovation can get through these folks that have such a stranglehold on the data. And sometimes management companies, and this is where I really encourage them, they need to start banding together and saying, that's our data, by the way. Yep. This is our information, not yours. It's ours. And we want to have written into our agreements that when we bring innovative companies and solutions, you have to have a way for them to be able to integrate for us, not you, us. And that's where we've got to, as an industry, we've got to get past that. We've got to band together and do that because it's just better for everybody. Innovation is better for everybody.
I'm so glad you made that point, because it is such an important point that it is their data. It really is 100% their data. And in order for their service partners or vendors to serve them better, they should, all those companies should have access to that data. And if they don't have it, then it just makes it much more difficult for those like newer, younger companies to really provide a higher quality, whether it's a higher quality integration or higher quality service, or to automate like workflows, all those things that will just provide much better value to the property management company, but they are not able to because that data is just like somewhere completely different. So for me, it's always been shocking that more property management companies are not like going after the big guys to, hey, you guys have all of our data. You need to absolutely make it as easy for everyone to access as possible.
It breaks my heart when I meet entrepreneurs coming into our industry and they're like so excited and have a great product. And they're like, wait, how much does it cost to integrate with these companies? And it just kills them. They just—
30,000, 100,000.
Yeah.
They can't do it. They can't do it. And so they go by the wayside because the management companies say, well, if you don't integrate with them, I can't work with you. Really?
Yeah.
But this solves your problem.
That's
not good for anyone.
You're right.
It's so weird to me.
Flipped, who has control in the situation.
And Robert, it's so weird to me when that exact situation happened. Like, it happened for us initially where we didn't have those integrations and they were like, oh, well, I guess we can't really do this. I'm like, you are bought into the solution. You know the value it's going to have. So why would that be a blocker for you? You should be the one going to those PMSs to say, hey, we need our data and make it available to this company.
Yeah.
And what for me is also interesting is that talking about how the property management companies go after other companies to get those sponsorships for their events, utilizing that data is just like one way to supplement that cost to say, hey, XYZ property software company, if you want to charge someone else for our data, you need to do some revenue share with us because that literally is our data.
Mm-hmm. Mm, that's interesting. That's interesting.
And then they could, if it's important to them for them to integrate with a new vendor, then they can share it back with the vendor.
Exactly.
And that covers that cost.
That's a good, that's a practical solution.
What's interesting about what you said, Robert, to start that point about the PMS system, locking it down, and Janet was calling it a data gate, which I think is a great way to put it.
That's a good way to put it. I saw that.
But those PMS companies, they know they're not innovators at this point. So all of them are more market and, mergers and acquisition companies at this point, right? They all are depending on the young companies to come in, show progress, and do the R&D in whatever area, and then purchase that company later to integrate into their stack. And so by being a data gate, they're stopping the innovation from happening, which hurts their own, you know, future earnings when they purchase that company, right? And pull it into their ecosystem. So, but since we're talking on how management companies can better use vendors, one thing that could, back to, I'm going to tie a couple points that you guys made together, but one idea would be, hey, look, I'm not sure, let's say that you're talking to Jude. You're like, Jude, I'm not sure that this is going to be a solution for us yet. And because of whatever, because you're not as integrated as we need you to be. However, I'm willing to sponsor you guys so that you guys can go to Yardi and we'll be your flagship customer for you to get that integration push through that you need. You use us, the management company A or whatever, as your test guinea pig on this. And then, you know, if things go well, you know, we can 12 months from now, we can talk about like an actual rollout. Because what Digible had happened was we needed to connect to all of those major players, and we got to Entrata very quickly. But Yardi and RealPage both shut us down. They said, we see you guys as competitive. We're not going to actually allow you guys to purchase a license. So I had the licenses to sign and I signed one and sent it back. And they said, never mind. I was told that you guys are a competitor and we can't do this deal. So for two more years, we couldn't connect to Yardi and RealPage. Finally, we got some big customers to be our sponsors and go to those companies and say, hey, knuckleheads, they're not competitors of yours. You need to connect to them. And now, you know, now we've got all the connections we need, but we were just getting blackballed basically behind the scenes. So I'm more of just trying to connect the dots, act as a sponsor for somebody, even if you like what they're doing, but they're not quite there yet. That doesn't mean you can't help push through so that they can innovate and continue their mission.
You know, something that I would recommend to multifamily property management companies and owners as well is to check with their vendors about which property management systems are easiest to work with, because it can be a real struggle for the multifamily companies when their property management system doesn't play nice with vendors. It's obviously difficult for us, but it's difficult for everybody.
Yeah, and I'm so glad that you mentioned it. I was actually going to do like a shout out to them, because they have been one of the easiest to work with. And it's really that example. And we have had that situation, Jennifer, that you mentioned, where someone is asking for our recommendation for, hey, do you guys work with this, this, and this? Here are the things that we are thinking about implementing. And for us, we have our preferred recommendation. So if someone is like, hey, we have this new asset and we want to implement this system or this keyless entry system or this whatever, we recommend the ones that we know are easy to work with. So like for the PMS, it's like Entrata is super
Entrata
easy.
Entrata we recommend as well.
Yeah.
Same. If they're making decisions around the property management software or the CRM, one of the questions that management companies should be asking is, how well do you play in the sandbox with new people, with new vendors? And I'll give a shout out. I normally don't name names, but I will tell you, Entrata, I loved it because they had all the API documentation. Our team knew how to do it. They
very easy.
Two days later, we were rocking and rolling, and Entrata really didn't have to do much. They just did a good job documenting. So this whole, well, we have to assign people, and no, you don't. That's not the reason. You're trying to monetize that, and that's not good for anybody.
Yeah, and that's what we always say as well. Like for us, we have to integrate with so many different things. And you look at how forward-thinking companies have their integration set up. In most situations, there is no human interaction like needed. Like we integrate with Google. Google doesn't have a team that you have to reach out to and set up meetings with in order to integrate with Google reviews or whatever. They just have the documentation set in a way that is very easy for a developer to read and then complete the integration.
Yeah.
And we don't pay them $30,000 a year for their integration.
That's all? It gets even more than that.
Yeah.
I will throw out one thing, and I don't know where we are in the time and all this. We kind of touched on this a little bit. Jennifer is a subject matter expert in her product, in her field. Jude is a subject matter expert in his field. I am in mine, and David, you are as well. And so we should know. Okay, everyone else is, but he's shaking his head no. When there is this interesting thing that happens sometimes when the management company will, I've seen this, where they kind of assume the role of they know better. And you know what? In some cases, what relative to their renter and to their, they do. There are some aspects where they absolutely do. And we as vendors really need to make sure we're listening. But that needs to be a two-way street. Like, we know what works and what doesn't work in artificial intelligence. We know why we're doing what we're doing. So when you ask for A, B, and C, and we tell you that doesn't work, you need to listen, because it doesn't work. We've had people that have said, no, no, I'll do it this way. We've actually done it. It just bombed. We're like, we told you this was not going to work. So there's this fine line between being willing to experiment as a vendor. We should. It makes our products better. But also recognize that we do know what we're talking about when it comes to this, our subject matter expertise. And we want to help you roll this out really, really well and make it a smooth solution and provide that feedback. So sometimes they kind of come in with their own game plan and they don't want to hear you. And they need to, because yeah, it'll just make it better.
Yeah, and that's another really great point. What for me, I always find interesting is that, like Robert, you said, like, we are subject matter experts and we have really unique insight, because for us, when we work with a client, we have worked with a very similar client here, 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 and here. So across the board, we have seen like what they do and what was successful and like what wasn't. We have done our implementations hundreds of times over. So when we say this is what we need and this is how we want to roll out, we're saying that from a perspective of, we have done this a lot. We have had a lot of trial and error, so we know this is what's going to happen. The typical pushback that we get, at least for our product, is like, oh, our residents are different. It's like, are they like really that different?
We hear that a lot.
The 20 to like 40-year-olds in California or in LA, are they really that different than the 20 to 40-year-olds in San Diego? It's like, not really. No, we have done this and we know how this works. And we have the data to like back it up as well too. That's probably the most interesting thing, because like, we actually have the data to back it up.
We don't get this very much anymore, but for a while when we're doing, especially the touchscreen applications, we work with marketing people who are very creative and they want to do so much creative stuff. And I'm like, we have done so much research into usability and focus groups and all this stuff. And we know what works and where to put buttons and what to include and what not to include that's going to convert tours to leases. And that's our job as your partner, is to convert tours to leases. But it's hard because they're like, they're more concerned about the creative approach to it than the deliverables. But that's we've gotten over that over time because people are now more used to our product.
Yeah. Well, I think point actually connects to the point earlier about consultants or where you, Jude, you were saying earlier that you get into people's systems, you see their processes and you see something that's broken. I think you and Robert were talking about that. And to your point, Jude, like, you're an expert in what you do. You get to see 30, 40, 50 management companies and how they work, whereas that management company just gets to see themselves, right? And so they should be almost like trying to, in some ways, probe you for that free added value that I mentioned along the way. Like, hey, your most successful customers do what? Or how do they implement this or whatever? That way they're not almost like tying a hand behind their back when they start, because they think it's their first time trying to do the rollout. So more making the point, use your vendor to and trust them, because they want it to be successful, right? So they're going to tell you the way to best be successful versus go build this crazy cool thing that they think is crazy cool, but it's not actually going to hit the metrics that they're interested in.
Yeah. And to that point, it's even easier when to approach that when you come with the perspective of, hey, these are the 3 to 5 problems that we have right now. How have you seen people like solve this? It just makes, if they come with that, it just makes everything significantly easier, because a lot of times the biggest challenge is just like change management and people not wanting to do things like differently. But if you come to your vendor or your strategic partner with the problems that you have and tell them, this is the problems I have, how do you recommend we solve this? It's so easy for them to say, this is how we've done it with other clients that had exactly the same problems, and here's how we can do it with you as well. So it just makes it much easier to come with the problems that you have rather than come in with preconceived like solutions to how you think that problem should be solved.
About 2 months ago, I had a management company. I can't for the life of me remember which one it was, a couple months ago. Best question I ever got. So what's the best rollout you guys have ever had with a management company and why? I was like, that's the best one. I've never had anyone ask.
No one has ever asked that.
And I was stunned and I went, I'm like, well, I have to think about that for a while. But that was a brilliant question because they said, that's how we want to do it. Whatever you recommend. And I went, oh my gosh, this is great. And that's a question that that people should be asking. On the flip side, we had a management company that absolutely would not hear anything we had to say. We kept saying we need to do A, B, C, and D. And they did not any of it. And so it was not working. Mm-hmm. And you're like, well, there's a reason why you're not listening to what we're telling you. So, you know, trust that we want it to work. Like, we need it to work.
Yeah.
We're going to do everything we can to make it work. And so we think every day, how do we make this rollout very successful? So let us help you kind of be that guide.
And the benefits of doing that is that it just kind of offloads the work from you to your partner, which is really what you want, mm-hmm. is to kind of offload things to them because they know how to do it. So they are going to do it as efficiently as possible. And Robert, as you said, everyone wants to make sure that it works. So they are going to implement the best practices to make sure that implementation works because it's a really small industry. If you try to do it with one company, it doesn't work, then they're going to tell all the other companies that, oh, this company doesn't know what they're doing. Mm-hmm. So your vendors are like on your side. Mm-hmm. They want to make it work as efficiently as possible.
Yeah, totally. And
on that note, just to be super pointed about it, we also like to have one main contact that's like the rollout person on their side. And every once in a while, we have vendors who want to have 17 people on a conference call and they're all responsible for something else. And I guarantee that will make the rollout worse.
It's like the clown car exercise.
Yes.
How many people can you fit into the clown car when you do onboarding? Yeah. We learned that we at one point had too many touch points and now it's just one. And and that goes both sides too, because sometimes you have management companies like, I don't know, wait, who am I supposed to be talking to? So having that one-to-one point person is a great idea.
Mm-hmm. To that point, again, I'll try to tie a few things together here, but having the key like contact is important, but knowing what their key goals are. So I think it feels like sometimes clients on the property management side try to like hold their cards close to the vest as if it's like the negotiation is still happening during the trial. But it's really important for them to come forward and say, hey, Jude, this is what success looks like to us, just so you know, so that Jude can say, whoa, hey, now we see success as this. So like, and then Jude, you could say this isn't going to work and you could save everybody time, or you can say, no problem. Understand your concern, client. We'll focus on that instead of the normal KPI we go with. I'm just going to say like, it's as we're trying to do this in a partnership way that Jennifer was mentioning earlier, it's important for like Robert to know his key KPIs or Jennifer, right? And if Robert or Jennifer is talking to a client, I'm sure that you guys are like, hey, this is what success looks like. Like, you guys help set that expectation. But if it's someone less experienced on, you know, any of our teams, a lot of times they're nervous to say, hey, here's what success looks like. So I'm just going to flip it back to the management company side. You should help define that, even if your vendor forgets to define it for you. So you can say, hey, this is what success looks like to us, or Robert, what does success look like? How do you guys usually measure this so that we can go into it? And then that person can be like, cool, I'm the buying decision maker, but you're going to be working with whoever on your day-to-day. But just know that whoever person is not your champion. I'm your champion, right? Because you guys have all worked with vendors too, where maybe David is the internal champion of it, but I'm not the one doing the day-to-day. So it's really important to, even if there is one point of contact, to sort of Jennifer's point, you know that like, okay, well, maybe there is though a decision maker sort of just beyond that contact, so that when it's important, you can pull that decision maker in.
Very good point. Oftentimes our onboarding contact is not the decision maker. Mm-hmm. It's important to make that distinction.
Yeah. And the really important part about having those like success metrics is that it's really helpful when it is communicated back to the day-to-day person, because a lot of times someone makes a decision to implement something, then you get to the day-to-day user and they really have no idea what it is. So you have to redo all that education, get the buy-in to say, hey, your whatever boss wanted us to implement this. Can you work with us to do it? So a key thing is really make sure that, like Robert said earlier, that the left hand is talking to the right hand and everyone's aligned. And the easiest way to be aligned is on those cycles.
That's one of the things that we changed too about our processes is at the beginning, after the sale is closed, but before we set something up, we have the decision maker. We have a conference call with everybody who's going to be using the product, touch the product in some way. And the decision maker starts by saying, we chose Pynwheel and this is why. So that right from the beginning, they get that it's their decision why we're coming in. We're not just like showing up on site 2 months later, telling people they have to use our product and they don't really understand how it fits into the whole scheme of things.
I'll throw out something that might be a little uncomfortable for people to hear. Do you see how often decision makers hide behind other people? That they'll have their people out there and they'll be doing the day-to-day, but the decision maker can't be, doesn't join the meetings, doesn't respond to emails. And so you have this filter that occurs. You actually have the vendor who's trying to work with the people up front to get communicated somehow back to the decision maker, and it gets lost in translation. And I don't think that, and again, this is not me just complaining. It's me saying that that's actually not good, because you're not hearing direct communication and interpretation from the vendor to the decision maker. This whole buffer that I see, and I see it play out time and time and time again, is not a good thing. So you've got these folks here, and then you got the decision makers, and you can never connect them. So I don't think you can make an informed decision if you're not talking to the source. So the decision makers need to be very, very involved in the process, the evaluation, the data, and the conversation. And so that practice, I think, just needs to stop. And we need to connect the right people at the right time.
Yeah, I agree. Every once in a while, we'll have a situation where a decision maker pops in, like something gets escalated to a decision maker, and they're like, wait, this needs to be solved right away. And they're like, fire alarms going off. And we're like, yes, absolutely. We're still waiting for this information.
One thing that... go ahead, Jude.
I was going to say, I think one fundamental change that I would really love to see in the industry is for the decision makers and everyone involved to think about working with vendors as part of their job. Because I think a lot of people think about evaluating software or solutions as this extra part of their job. So it gets kind of deprioritized, where they prioritize like everything else. But I forgot what investor, this is something that was said a long time ago, like software is eating the world. So software technology is a day-to-day part of like everyone's job. So as a business leader, you have to think about acquiring technology and implementing technology as a key part of your responsibilities. So you want to be as involved as possible in that process and really think about it as your biggest like differentiator, because if you have used software to solve all the issues or problems that come up, that puts you in a much more competitive position than the company that's purely trying to differentiate based off of amenities.
Yes, I love that. Also, like that. On the same note, and this is maybe a controversial thing to say, it always causes me to pause when I hear that companies have formed innovation teams, because in my experience, there is no faster way to stop innovation than by creating an innovation team. It's just like analysis paralysis. You have a ton of people coming in. They're like, wait, before we do anything, we need to look at every single piece of software that we're using, and we need to set up KPIs and goals, and then we need to start from scratch. And it's just like absolutely stops innovation in its tracks.
Analysis paralysis. That's exactly right. Kills innovation. It's decision by committee. That never really works well. It just doesn't work well. You need to have someone who's capable of evaluating it and make recommendations and go with the recommendation.
I would disagree with that a little bit, because I think for the property management industry, it is something that's like needed for a couple of reasons. One of those is because for a property management company, they need someone that's looking at things from a cohesive perspective. So to understand like, this is how this process works here. This is how this process works here. This is how this process works here. So I think having a team that is able to look at the organization across the board is helpful as they think about where are all the challenges. To your point, it definitely can lead to a decision by committee or all these like issues. The way to really solve that is to make sure that the innovation team isn't just made up of like five people at the C-suite, but it's rather made up of the frontline people, the midline people, everyone that is facing those like things. And then what I've seen work really well is you have a core innovation team, but then you also have additional segments that are pulled in when it's needed. So if we are looking to implement a technology that is focused on marketing, let's bring in the marketers to give their feedback. So it's really implementing an innovation team in a way that is more optimized rather than just like people that act more like gatekeepers rather than people that are really trying to drive innovation.
And that's a good point of clarification. When in my mind, when I'm thinking of the innovation team, I am thinking of the higher up C-suites, and it all goes for a vote once a month and nothing ever really happens. So I think you need your operators. So I think you're referring to having your operators involved.
And it built on Jude's point before, most innovation teams on the management side that I've seen are just people that it's an extra part of their job. It's like an extra committee they're on versus having real decision-making power or seeing it as like they have the decision-making power. I think there are different ways to do it where it's like, hey, innovation team, we want you to solve X this year, or we're hoping one of these three things you will solve this year versus the gatekeeping and the politicking that ends up happening in a lot of those companies. I know we're close on time. I do want to make another point and then we can go a little bit over if you guys have some stuff. But one of the things that was brought up was kind of the theme was SLAs, meaning like what are Jennifer's SLAs for her? I am really interested in testing a reverse SLA for clients to say like, hey, client, you call us a partner. Yes, our SLA is 5 days or whatever, but our expectation is that you respond within 2 days or whatever it is. Because to Jennifer's point, she can't get her stuff launched in 2 to 4 weeks if the client doesn't meet what she's expecting from the SLA. So the way I've been testing this most recently is I have a couple slide decks on new client pitches that I've done where I say like, hey, here's our SLAs. These are based on these expectations from you. What I haven't then done is, and I was just talking to Nicole about this because she moved into our chief experience officer position, but let's track how a client's performing against that. So like, hey, client, we have a client that doesn't like our 4-day work week. They say like, hey, I can never get in touch with you, you know, in case an emergency happens on a Friday and blah, blah, blah. But when you look at the email history with us, they've emailed us like twice on a Friday in like the last 18 months. And that, and we never missed our SLA. Our Friday still counts as a business day. So we still will get their campaign launched within 3 days. So I'm more of just saying the reverse SLA is how many times are you asking us to break our own SLAs? You asked us whatever 6 times in the last quarter to do this in 1 day versus our typical 3 days. So just a concept. I'm curious if you guys have any feedback on that.
I mean, it's a mutual respect. It's I think, and again, being constructive, communication's key. I will add, I agree. I will add a commitment of time to do reviews. So rather than back and forth sometime, we always have a standing practice that every 4 months we interview for the job. Every 4 months, we're going to sit down with you. We're going to go through, it could be 15 minutes. So just give us 15 minutes every 4 months. We're going to go through a couple data points, some observations and some recommendations. And I think that goes a long way for both companies because they're committing their time to each other. And be there on that time. We understand stuff happens. It does. You have to reschedule. That's okay. But when it keeps getting rescheduled 6 months later, now you're getting away from having an optimum experience. So I always recommend we're going to put 4 months with each company. Please make sure that you're there and we will be there ready and prepared to have that conversation. Mm-hmm. So it's a mutual commitment. And that tends to work really well to foster that relationship long term. Yeah.
That's a great idea. I like that. Because sometimes it's hard for us to get in touch with people and we have new features that we're like, we have a new feature
exactly
and you can use it for free. You just need to know about it. We have a hard time getting in touch with them to let them know, or there's turnover, obviously. And sometimes that doesn't get communicated.
Yeah. And that, thank you for driving home the point. That's kind of actually was the impetus behind that was you actually have new features that we want to show you that you're going to want to use. It doesn't cost you anymore, but we just need to show you first and see if you want to implement it. So you're kind of missing out on what you might be able to be using with this product.
Yeah.
Cool. Yep. Well, let's wrap up here. I'll go around the horn. You guys can let people know how best to get in touch with you. And then if you have any parting thoughts on, you know, anything on the subject. So, ladies first, Jennifer, I'll let you kick off.
My email address is jennifer@pynwheel.com. Pynwheel is with a Y. And you can also just go to pynwheel.com and send messages and we get them around quickly and easily to everybody who works there.
Cool. Jude?
So check us out at getflamingo.com and check out our LinkedIn page. We have some really, really great content from memes to long, long essays on how different industries would run your apartment.
And if they're ever in Chicago, you'll
take definitely hit me up and we can head over to Wasabi or we can go to Violet Hour to grab a drink.
Nice. There you go.
Robert?
Just for fun, I was going to give out Jen Cypher's mobile number. So call after midnight, but mine's easy. It's Robert. you'll take. It's Robert at BetterBot.com. Welcome to email me anytime.
Cool. Well,
come to Denver and David and I will both take you out for a drink.
Deal.
There you go. Double drinks.
Let's do it.
Well, thank you guys. This is super helpful. I appreciate you all. It's can feel uncomfortable to kind of do a session of this nature. So just thank you for being so, you know, open and honest and willing to take a shot on it. And Robert, thank you for the inspiration. I feel like I'm going to want to do it again. So this won't be a one and done because I got a lot of value out of it. It's helpful. I just to learn you guys. So thank you all. Really appreciate it.
You bet. Yeah, hey, thanks for having us on.
Thanks for the invitation.
Enjoyed it. See you guys.
Yeah.
All right, Jan, are you bringing us back?
All right.
We lost you.
I think you thought that was time to.
Robert, that was a really good idea.
Oh. First of all, let's give a big round of applause to our panelists. So thanks for the sound effects.
That's awesome.
There we go. And the ringtone. maybe somebody hit another button. We are going to do another shorter session after our little break, which is all about Google Analytics 4. So looking at how to prepare, what's changing, how to get excited about it. And until then, we're going to do one more breakout room session. And then there's going to be a few sessions back to back. So take another break, come back for the next session. It is starting at, let me flip to the next thing, at 2:45. So we'll see you back in just a little bit.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Robert. Thanks, Jennifer. See you guys later.
Bye.
Erica, did you relocate?
I did. I'm in the living room, sitting down.
Nice. Comfortable. I figured, I was like, I'll go a little bit long. I feel like they could have gone another like 15 or 20 minutes, but I was like, since the breaks, I was like, I'll go another, whatever, 5 extra minutes. So it's fun. They were good.
That's great.
All right. Who am I bringing in here? G4, Katie, Tammy, Megan. Okay.
Yep. They might be outside, but
no problem. I'll mute myself here and I'll get them all situated.
Thank you.
All right.
Here's around. We're never gonna sit in the center.
So short. I tried it.
Yeah.
God, please, yes.
Okay, hello. We got two out of three people are ready with their headphones on.
I will.
Yes, which camera people, this is the camera straight ahead. Okay, yep. Cool.
And then.
That's okay.
Amazing.
I really want to put my intro script.
Do it.
For all the energy
we are, I feel like I'm really close to you. I'm gonna use your chair just like just.
Okay. So your slides are down here. Arrow for.
I need to let people in.
Oops.
Don't let people in. Got it. Counterintuitive.
Yeah. Yeah, I know you want to be a good host. I'll. Bring people back when we're ready.
Okay. So if I'd ask everyone to like those questions to chat, I'll be able to go back right through there like a normal would. Okay. Cool. Oh, that'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Just to hide my slide that I have over here.
Mine are just out here, okay. Front and center.
Just trying to make it easier. Thank you. Okay.
Katie, is the mic close to your mouth? Because it's a little.
How about right now? Is that better?
Yeah.
How about me?
I could put it like right there.
You're great.
I don't want you to hear me breathing.
Okay. Sound check.
Ooh.
I can hear myself a lot better now.
That's fantastic. Too.
Okay. What's the like ready, set, go indicator? Oh, okay.
Awesome.
Okay. Very cool.
And then Megan, is your headset working?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yep. You're good.
Okay. Perfect.
Cool. Okay. Sounds good.
Don't have to look at me. Can do.
Where's Ruby? Okay, cool. She can't be alone, so.
She took off. She's shopping.
This will work perfectly, actually, because if I read it like this, it looks like I'm looking right at the camera.
Yeah, it does. Do that.
Amazing.
I'll be looking you're down.
Totally,
at my
yeah. Thank you. It made me, today's weather really made me Jones for like a digital sweater, you know, like a big, thick, chunky sweater for the first time this year, but. A Digible ugly Christmas sweater would be amazing.
I want a fuzzy yeah. hoodie.
How do we make it ugly?
That's
a great question. We ask for too many people's opinions.
Before we get started, is David still close by?
No.
Okay, we just wanted to let him know if he comes back. Before we get started, there is only a very short transition once you are done and he's back on. Okay. So just as a reminder, when we wrap up the session, I'll distract everyone kind of like a magician for like a minute. Okay. But in that minute, we'll need you.
We'll get him.
We'll need you to clear out.
Get David back.
We've timed our presentation a couple of times. We anticipate we'll probably wrap up earlier than like, you know, the last minute. So we should have just a little bit of extra time.
Yeah. Especially questions.
Yeah. Depending on questions.
We'll be fast.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Time than you want to fill.
And I'll text David to let him know to be on deck for the next session.
Awesome.
Yeah. Oh.
Okay. Well, we still have a minute or so before I bring everyone back.
Okay.
I know it's like logistics. I know. I shut the paper. I just slide it.
This was a better idea, doing all four on one.
It's hard to read though, if you needed to read.
How are you feeling? Again,
but
good. Yeah, you feel like you're good where you're sitting and everything?
Yeah. This is okay. Good. Comfy.
I feel like I'm really blessed. Yeah. I feel like I have dry mouth.
I definitely do. I've been twitching my foot all day.
Like all of the preparations have culminated in a single foot twitch. Yeah. That's pretty impressive. Yeah.
And our presentation's going to be there so we can see it, right? No.
No, it's going to be here.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. Okay. Can you see it?
I don't know. We'll find out. Okay. It looks perfect.
Okay, well, it doesn't respond to that, so figure that out.
I will play some music. I'll bring everyone back, and then I will let you know once everybody's here.
Okay, cool.
All right.
Related.
Yeah. Okay. Pumped. Amazing. And I think slowly but surely everybody's coming back.
Okay.
I'm gonna pass over the mic to the studio.
All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the 2022 Digible Summits GA4 Roadmap and Recommendations. I'm Katie, Senior Account Manager here at Digible, and I'm joined by Tammy, our SEO strategist, and Megan, our Digital Strategy Lead. Today, we're going to talk about what we've learned regarding the changes happening with Google Analytics, and we're also going to talk about what we are most looking forward to. We have been really lucky in recent weeks. We've been hosting weekly meetings with representatives and technicians at Google, and they've been very generous in answering our questions, providing some valuable insights to us, and we will definitely touch on those in the coming half an hour. I know that this is a very hot topic, and we would love questions to come through the chat. We're going to hold those for the end, but we'll do our best to answer them. With all of our extensive conversations we've been having, there were even some questions that could not be answered by the Google team. So we will just be really transparent when those topics come up and do our best to answer the ones that we can. Okay. Let me get this here. All right. So it's been a long time since we digital marketers have found ourselves floundering like fledglings in the Google Analytics space. So we're going to start off today in our presentation like the spring chickens that we are and address what is changing, why those things are important, all with the goal of framing these J4 changes as easily attainable and approachable for everyone, no matter what your experience with analytics has been in the past. First and foremost, hold on, let me get my presentation here. Okay, so first and foremost, J4 should be thought of as a system upgrade. It's a revamp of the same platform we all know and love. It pledges to be the future of analytics with advanced cross-platform tracking, AI-driven data, and a privacy-centric strategy. J4 is a brand new product that's full of so many goodies. Previous platform upgrades pale in comparison. The roadmap, let's see. Okay, so the roadmap of Google Analytics started way back in 2005, long before a significant portion of our team here at Digible was in the working world, but it has been around for a while.
I think you had mentioned, does anybody remember Urchin? And I was like, sadly, I do.
And shortly after that 2005 Urchin, the iPhone was introduced in 2007. The next big milestone was in 2015 when mobile queries outdistanced desktop queries. That was a huge shift for us marketers. And in the coming year, we're going to see even more changes. The sunsetting of universal analytics, we all know that's coming in July of next year. But looking beyond that, 6 months later, we're going to start seeing the sunsetting or the cookie deprecation of Google products is going to phase in.
I think that's where most people are most nervous, is getting rid of those cookies.
Yeah. Yikes. So we got to get the J4 thing down before we can even think about what comes after that. But yes. Okay. So why are things changing?
So why is it important? As the industry changes with privacy restrictions, there is a limit on the data that we can receive. So GA4 implements machine learning and data modeling to gain more reliable data measurement in this privacy-centric world. So GA4 is really future-proofing for upcoming privacy restrictions, such as browser restrictions on the use of cookies and personal data regulations. So the bottom line is it's future-proofing for privacy, the privacy-centric world. It's future-consented, it's modeled, and it's first-party. So it's really preparing for what's to come.
Yeah, I think that's super interesting. A couple of the things that stood out to me in terms of like the, I guess the standout features is going to solve a big question that's been in my mind in the as a digital marketer over many years, and that's the single unit user journey. So in, for example, I'm just going to skip ahead to my next slide here and then I'll bounce back, but here's a great layout of what the GA4 user journey is going to look like on the analytics side compared to what we're used to with universal analytics. So let's say, you know, a user is seeing your ad for the first time on his mobile device, on the train, on his way into work. Well, that's going to count as a paid impression. But let's say he waits till he gets home that night, gets on his personal desktop, does an organic search for your brand, and goes to the website and converts. Well, we don't see that connection there between, you know, organic traffic and paid dollars. And what we're really excited for, which we will talk more about coming up, is that those things are going to be connected and you're going to see user deduplication, which is another feature of that. So there's a lot of really exciting things happening in terms of the user journey that is going to directly connect us to the questions about attribution that we've had over the years. Let me just bounce back up here. So how are they going to do that? Well, they're going to use three different things, three different categories, and that's going to be the user ID, the Google signals, and device IDs. So in the scenario where we might not have all three, they will compile the data they have from the other two, and those variations will exist. But Google will use some of the other tools we'll talk about coming up here in a second to fill in all of those gaps for us. Okay, so conversion modeling.
Conversion modeling. So this first paragraph here is a bit technical in terms of how modeling can work. It's data modeling is really compensating for the absence of signals by using models that are trained on observable data. That's still kind of confusing. So what that means is that when there is enough reliable data in your GA4 account, Google can start learning behaviors and modeling data in places where you would normally lose that insight due to privacy restrictions.
Awesome. Do you have a couple of examples?
Awesome. So modeling can fill in the gaps when we have some examples here. This is not all encompassing, but a few situations we might run into, such as when browsers don't allow conversions to be measured with third-party cookies, potentially when browsers limit the time window for first-party cookies. We all know Apple's app tracking transparency policy. And then lastly, when conversions happen on different devices. So really the key takeaways from modeling are that we can recover conversions that otherwise would not have been measured. We can improve bidding optimizations through better data, and we are still privacy safe with hashing of first party customer data.
Awesome. Right. So let's do a comparison, shall we?
Yeah, so this is the nitty gritty. This is where we're going to break it down.
Okay, fun stuff. So let us compare.
Okay. All right.
All right. Let's take a high look. Let's do high level overview first. And we're going to just kind of see the differences here. The main differences, there's three. So we've got measurement. Universal Analytics, it was session-based, or is currently, since it's still around for a little while. And it is going to present you with all of your information based upon a time session. So 1 week, 1 day, 6 months, whatever you choose, and then it's going to show your metrics based on that time session. Whereas GA4 takes it away from the time-based, still time-based when you look things up, but it's going to start with the event first. It's going to ask you for what events you want to see or what conversions do you want to see, and it's going to show you the same metrics, so you know, time on page, things like that, but all related to those events. That will change reporting, just because it was limited prior to the rollout of GA4, where they didn't have a lot of ways to do what Katie's example was, the person who looks at the ad during, you know, the commute and then comes back and uses the, you know, computer at home, maybe had also checked at work. So three different devices might have resulted in three different visits, three different user sessions. But now we're going to go to the full cross-device, cross-platform way of reporting, and they'll be able to say, hey, that was the same person. We know that from the logins. We know that from the way that we're tracking. And it's going to be a much more complete and full understanding of how people are using what we're doing in marketing to complete that whole journey. And then finally, automation. So everybody loves automation. it was very limited in UA4. There's not a lot that you can do. It wasn't entirely absent, but it was hard to connect. Where in GA4, they're using the machine learning to simplify the insights that they can discover through, you know, data modeling and predictive audiences, things like that.
Now we're ready
for the deep dive. So let's go in and be a little more granular now. And we're going to say what's changing, what's going away. So views no longer in GA4. What you get is data filters on reports. So what people liked most about views was you could set up something like a view that had your raw data, like unfiltered data, and then you could have separate views for maybe, you know, your team to filter out your staff. So getting rid of the IPs in the office. So that takes those guys out. Then might also include taking out your marketing team, their IPs, taking out your developing team. Those guys are gone. And then you're left with hopefully what is your data that just shows what your marketing performance is. Yeah, a little bit cleaner. But now you can do that same thing in reports, right in the reports, much easier. Session-centric, as we mentioned in the previous slide. So no longer are your reports going to be based on sessions. It's event-based. That's going to be a big change. Sessions are not going away, though. Don't want you to think that, oh, we have no more sessions anymore. Can't report on that. That's not true. They're still there. They're just going to be based on the events first. And then goals. We don't have goals in GA4. We have events and conversions. So there's a lot of standard events that come with GA4. They're pre-set up, but you can also get really nitty gritty. You can set your own events up. So it's going to come with your stock ones, but you're going to add all the ones that are important to you. And then you're going to say, hey, out of these, I don't know, 15, 20 events that I have in here, I want 6 of these to be conversion based because these are my leads. These are what I want to track. So that's going to give us a lot more information. And then custom reports is going to go away. And now we're going to have two sections in GA4. We're going to have reports, which is going to give you your unsampled data. It's going to be 100% of the data that you have in there from your traffic. And then explorations, which might include some sample data from those, you know, audiences that they are using behind the scenes.
Yeah. And for those of us who don't have a ton of working knowledge of Universal Analytics and definitely haven't taken a peek at GA4 yet, the way I think about session versus event fundamentals, which is how they're trying to deviate and show us a bigger picture, is that the sessions show you what caused someone to come to your site the second they click onto the site and then what happened within the site. And an event model that we're going to be moving towards is going to allow you to connect a lot more dots about what's happening long before they get to your website. And then it's going to provide additional details on where you lose a user in terms of that conversion journey once they get to the site. So there's a lot more complexities. There's a much bigger, more robust storytelling ability here. And I think that that's really the takeaway is, you know, until you're getting into it and you're setting up those goals and taking a look at what kind of journeys you want to track, think about the potential that could be involved in that. Our world is going to change. It's going to open up and become so much bigger. So, you know, we're sad about bounce rate. maybe not so much, but you know, that's for the past. There are so many new, more important nuances coming our way. And that's something that we're getting really excited about.
100%. And also it's going to be more visual. It's going to be a lot better to see things. Yes. We'll talk about that more in a minute.
Yeah, we've got some good stuff. Awesome. Yes, so true. All right.
Okay, so what are we excited about? So much.
Many things.
I mean, everything that we just mentioned is exciting. In a nerdy way, maybe just us, but let's take
digital
a peek.
Nerd stuff.
Digital nerd. Let's take a peek at some of the other things that we're excited about. Katie, do you have anything that you're excited about?
I sure do. And this is something that's super simple. This is super approachable. This is for those folks who have very little experience with universal analytics. But I remember when I got my start in the digital world and I didn't know where to find anything in Google Analytics or in universal analytics. And I would go up to that search bar and type in my query and I would get a bunch of not so great results that weren't exactly helpful to me. But with J4, it's a totally different thing. So imagine when you go to your typical Chrome search bar to look for like a pair of shoes or where to eat dinner, how refined and good those search results are. It's going to be a similar experience within the J4 dashboard. So I encourage you guys that if you have a question about, hey, how's my traffic today? Or what's my paid media traffic coming in like? You can actually Google that very sentence and get very well-placed results for you. So that ease of use, that user-friendly vibe, that's something that is very nice with a lot of changes. You know, change is hard. So start there if you don't know where else to start.
Change is hard, but having help along the way is good. Yes. I also like you can find everything from, you know, reports to you can ask it, what does page load speed mean? Because you're looking at it in a report and you're like, well, I don't know what that means. Yes. And it'll come up with help topics as well.
You could even Google like, why doesn't bounce rate matter anymore? All right. So we've got some more things that we're super excited about.
This is the part that I'm really jazzed about because I'm a visual learner. So going into reports in Google Analytics, for those of you who use it a lot, you probably kind of hate the way it looks in there.
Yeah.
But they're going to have better visuals with GA4. And that makes things so much easier, especially as somebody who works in there a lot. So it's meant to be more digestible. It's meant to help you see things a lot quicker. Like you can identify trends, you can identify those dips, and then you're like, oh God, look at that thing that fell. I have to go figure out what happened there. You can diagnose issues. And they say that there's going to be at least two of those visual elements for each section above the data tables. And sometimes there might just be visuals.
Yeah.
And I'm all about that. Yeah. So as you can see, it looks really pretty.
Yes, it does. And can you customize this at all?
Yeah, you can. You can go in there and even add things to it. So there's always a section where you can go in there and add new things to it. So,
amazing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Very cool.
Cool. All right. What else?
What else are we excited about? Well, with the better visuals comes better reporting and better campaign data. So we're going to be able to track, like Katie mentioned, the attribution journey a little bit more. We're going to be able to see where Megan's ads help my organic campaign and maybe where my campaign actually helps out the ads. I don't know if that's going to happen, but we hope so.
Everything helps everything.
Loves each other. Yes. Yeah. We're going to be able to track conversions better. So we'll know, you know, even though the organic session happened after the paid ad was seen, it'll give us like a percentage of, you know, it helped out this much. We'll know how many times, how many visits that ad led people to get to the organic site. It'll add in some modeled conversions along the way, and that will give us a more accurate report telling us a complete story, because we will be missing the data from the people who opt out of the privacy. So at least that's not going away. I know it's also going to be included where it can't. Google said that if it doesn't have a high reliability rate on that information, it won't include it, but it'll put it in direct. So that way we'll be able to look in direct and still see things, which means we might see an increase in direct visits and direct traffic. I did ask Google if we can do any analysis in there, like dial down and figure out where it came from. And we'll see what happens.
So their answer was they didn't know.
They didn't quite answer that question, but we'll see. We'll see what we can do when we get in there. Yeah, for sure. Question. And then it'll help us improve what we're doing here, you know, marketing wise. So we can make our campaigns better. We can make automated bidding better, and it all works as a nice cohesive machine.
Love that. Okay. I think we've got one other thing that we wanted to touch on. Oh, yeah.
Yes. This is exciting. And this might just be me, but I'm really excited about Google Optimize. So it's obviously existed before. Some of you who are like, oh, that's been around, Tammy, that's not new. But actually, they've integrated it with GA4. And so we can use all of those new modeling experiences. We can use the new data. We can combine it with the tests that we're running to get an even better picture of how an A-B test might be performing, which might lead to better conversions, which is always what you hope for in an A-B test. But what we'll be able to do too is possibly do Google Ads targeting, because up until now, it's been only available to the 360 users, and that's the paid platform on analytics. And it costs a lot, so there's not a ton of people that use that, huge businesses. But
yeah, I don't think I've worked with anybody who's had access to that, so that's going to be exciting.
That is exciting. So now it's available to us on the free platform, and so we can see what that means. Wow. Tests ahead.
Yeah.
Someday. Exactly. Let's see what we can do with this.
Have you ever worked with anybody using that?
Nope, never.
Wow. Okay, well, we'll all be spring chickens together.
Yes, we will. All right. Oh, did you even mention we are the Digible Chicks for this whole thing?
Yeah, because we're the Digible J4 Chicks, in case you were wondering about the theme of the presentation. So you can't hear anybody laughing at my jokes.
I laugh. It's,
okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Hopefully they are. All right.
All right. So one thing to keep in mind, and if there's nothing else that you guys take away from this presentation, we want you to know that you should set GA4 up as soon as possible. Super important. You can set it up along with your universal analytics. They can both run together at the same time. And it's important because you need data in order to make Google Analytics super helpful. The more data, the better. I love more data all the time.
Data.
And then as universal analytics sunsets down, GA4 is going to continue. So at least we're going to have that continue. We'll have all the back data and it'll travel with us.
Yeah. And an important timeline to know for that, guys, is that with the July 1st sunset, we are encouraging everyone at that time to download all of their historical reporting. But we were told by Google earlier this month that there is an undetermined amount of time, likely 3 to 6 months, that if you have, that you will still be able to access your UA dashboard as it stands today, as long as you have all of those properties set up and initialized and have like your goals tracking. So that will continue to aggregate data for you, but you won't be able to make any additional changes to it after the July 1st. So they are going to give you just a tiny bit of time to, you know, for the people who need that last push to get out of there. But we don't know exactly when that's going to end. So I wouldn't count on it. Just some food for thought there.
Awesome.
All right.
And then with that, having GA4 on earlier, you'll be able to build historical data, capture more of the trends that you see, like starting now, if you have it going, it's going to be able to capture in arrears. And you can take advantage of all the new things that they have in there right now, plus all the new things that they add, because we all know Google will continue to add more things to this.
And that is actually verified by some of the calls that we had this year and recently, that more changes are coming. One of the things that might be in your mind is, well, when is Digible going to show us the J4 tracking in our reports? And the answer to that question is as soon as Google provides an API for agencies. And if your next question is, okay, what's the timeline for that? That was also our question for Google that they could not answer. So we will be staying on top of that, keeping you guys in the know. But at this point, it is another undetermined amount of time.
But it's on our radar.
It is. It's on our radar. We got that covered, so you don't have to worry about it. But yeah. Okay. Well, that was our final stuff that we're excited about. I see that we have a lot of questions in the chat.
Oh, boy.
So I wanted to say thank you guys for listening to this like very technically heavy new thing that's coming out. But we hope that at this point you feel a little bit more comfortable about, you know, whether or not this is achievable for everyone, no matter what your experience level is. And
don't be afraid. I think we were all a little bit nervous.
Oh, but, I was super nervous.
I got certified.
We got certified.
Yeah, getting certified. It's not as bad as it sounds.
Our whole company will be certified by the end of the year. So we will, you know, you'll have experts at your back. So, yes. Okay. So I want to open this up for some questions. Let me just pull up the chat and take a quick peek at the questions. Thank you, Sean, for laughing at my jokes. Big shout out to you. Okay, let me just scroll. Wow, there's a lot. this? Oh, this is the previous chat. Okay, bear with me.
It's like, well, I don't know the answer to that question.
This was not something I practiced before we got started. So yes, David, real humans do work at Google. And it's very difficult to get one on the phone, much less Zoom, so that you can see their face in real time. But
and
I
multiple
did.
Times.
And multiple times, the same people over and over again, not different folks. So we felt, and that's all Megan's magic. Yes. That's not for me or Tammy. That's Megan's got the connections. Okay. Lots of conversations about robots dressed as humans. Yes, there, we did think about that.
Okay. We're going to dress up like chicks, you guys, or like chicken chicks. You're lucky. We could just do that.
There's some great jokes in here about making up for a lack of signals and casual dating. So, okay. So one of the questions from Sean, when does Digible plan on switching fully to J4? So yeah, just to kind of reiterate what we said before, we have been encouraging our clients to initialize J4 and get that set up and running as soon as possible. So we've been, that's been our recommendation for most of the year. But if you haven't yet, that's okay. And if you have any questions about how to do that, reach out to your account managers or reach out to me. I'm more than happy to provide you with, you know, walkthrough videos or even like help you do that via Zoom.
Yeah, Jay had some pretty helpful tutorials that we used when we looked into a couple of our clients.
Yeah. Okay. And Allie laughed at my jokes. That's great. Thanks, yes. And I like this survey question from David. If we were allowed to rename J4, what would it be?
Oh, geez.
Ooh. Nobody answered that question. Oh, I'm so shocked. Megan, what do you think?
Oh, I don't know.
I'm putting you on the spot.
The next Google, the next generation.
Yeah. I like that. Oh, Kim's got a great question. Thank you, Kim. Will the removal of universal analytics goals affect how we import them to Google Ads, or will events and conversions just replace goals?
Events and conversions will replace goals. We'll be able to import those to Google Ads as well. So they're named differently, but we'll more or less be able to get the same information.
Okay.
Just takes a bit of work.
Yes. Yes. We have to import from Universal Analytics to GA4 and then back to Google Ads. So it's a roundabout process to get there, but we're still able to get that measurement.
And kind of what we've been trying to visualize what this process is going to look like for us on our end in terms of, you know, how we're going to pull in the data from your paid campaigns. And it's going to be fairly manual. Google doesn't have a agency solution for that. So it is one by one, property by property, and goal by goal.
I seemed a little surprised when we asked that question. I know. Like, really?
They're like, well, we could ask some people that we know here. You know? So that was the support that we received. But, you know, we still got a ton of valuable information, and we're more than happy to answer questions from anybody that has them. I anticipate that what you've learned here today, hopefully some of it was new, but that more and more will come available, especially over the next 6 months, I think is going to be that crunch time. I don't think we're going to see too many changes in the months as we get closer to July 1st. So you do not have the whole month of July. We have the whole month of June. So that's just an important thing to remember too. But if we don't have any other questions, David, great one. When J4 was announced, they said that we could more easily push data into J4. Do you all have an update on that? For example, I'd love you to push the pricing of a unit that an event triggered for.
So yeah, they have, you can upload information to BigQuery and use that as a database like storehouse for your information. You would give all of the Digible users like a user ID, and you could feed that in, and that would take some of that technical coding that our engineering team might be really, really good at or something. But yeah, you can definitely upload that information to BigQuery and use it.
What is BigQuery, Tammy? Tell us if you know. Is that the wrong question?
No. I don't know more than it's a big warehouse database storage thing that Google's using, and it's huge. Okay. How's that for an answer?
Do you think it's free or is it a paid service?
I believe it's free.
Okay.
I don't know if it's free. Like if you use a ton of it, you might have to start paying, but I know that you can initially start is free.
Okay.
To start.
All right, great. Hopefully we answered your question, David. You're welcome.
Anyone else have any questions?
Anything else?
I'm curious if anyone out there is actually using GA4 either solely, like they don't have UA going. And if so, do you, I guess if you aren't using UA, you can't say whether or not you like it or not. But I was going to say, do you like it? You probably do.
Mm. So we've got a solid no from Kim. Sean, you like it?
Awesome. Okay, that's great. I like it too.
All right.
I'm afraid. That's a good one. Yes.
Well, that's, yes. I don't think you're alone there, Kim. You know, I think that that's also the standpoint of a lot of us here. You know, change is always scary. But as long as we remember that a lot of these concepts are similar, if not exactly the same as the ones in Universal Analytics, it's just the conversion tracking that's going to change. So, well, it's not only that, but, you know, you could at least silo it a little bit like that in your mind to help. But okay. Well, I don't see any more questions coming through. Anything else, ladies? All right. Well, this is your Digi J4 chicks signing off.
Okay, big round of applause. Thank you so much for sharing some of those details. Also, because there's a switchover happening in the studio and David is coming back, I'm going to ask you all if you're watching, if you're open to a challenge. Let's see if we can solve a couple of riddles before David comes back, because this is a really quick switchover. There's no breakout rooms. All I have is this. There's a couple of locks, and each lock is a challenge. Let's see how many we can actually get done before David is back. I'm going to put on some music. I'll put on the first one. If you know the answer, type it into the chat. Okay, what has keys but no locks, space but no room, you can enter but you can't exit. If you know what it is, type it into the chat. And let's see if we can figure this out. I can see keyboard. Let's type it in. Let's see if that is correct. It is. All right. First one unlocked. And David, you let me know when you're ready to go. Whenever. How many triangles are in this picture?
Do two more just because it's fun.
All right. How many triangles are in this picture? Let's see. What's your guess? Ooh, I'm guessing three. Yes, three is correct.
All right, we'll do
one more because David was really quick. What are the next three numbers in this sequence? I am curious who can solve this. It's Jenny says 5, 8, and 13. It is correct. Good job. Jenny, you have to let us know, why was it 5, 8, and 13? And while you type that into the chat, I'm going to stop sharing and let David bring up his slides.
I didn't see it until Jenny said it, but I think it was because you were adding them. Is that what she just said?
Yes, add the two previous numbers.
Yeah.
Perfect. Nice. Good job.
I like
that. All right, David, we're ready for you.
Yeah, I'm told I have a quick 30 minutes, so and I think I have like 38 slides, so I'm going to go really quick here. I figured I'd put slides up that make me look really smart, but not give you guys time to read them so that you know that it wasn't really smart. I also stole like almost every one of these slides from our chief data officer, so they did come from someone smart. All right. All right, so I'm here to talk about the Fiona MOS, or the Marketing Operating System. This is just how Fiona is evolving. So I'll go through a little bit of history, but I thought I'd start here with the vision. So Fiona's core focus is to help digital marketers, operators, and partners achieve their goals through world-class technology. Obviously, apartment marketing is a niche. And then our 10-year target is to build the largest footprint in multifamily marketing in order to make a more collaborative, happier, and forward-thinking industry. Some of you would have heard this from us before. We're not trying to get big just for big sake, but it's more so we can help folks be more like, so that's just more collaborative. If you joined the panel I had earlier with vendors, you would have heard us talking about how many of the big companies in the space, you know, I think Janet was saying data gate your information and different things like that. So that's where a lot of this is coming from. And then our go-to-market strategy is working with management companies and owners who have a centralized marketing champion who gets it once and has the capacity to make changes. So the real vision statement is for all marketing to begin and end inside of Fiona. And I'll take us a little bit backwards here on things about how we came to this conclusion. So what is MarTech? This is a common framework you will see across the marketing technology space. You'll have an analytics side of things, which are, you know, things that you're familiar with, such as analytics, which we just had the session on. You have the intelligence side of things, automation, and CRM. This framework, though, doesn't exist within property management specifically. So that's what, just hold that thought. We'll come back to it. Also, the MarTech landscape has changed a lot. If you look back in 2011, there were only 150 MarTech companies. And as of May 22, you'll see there were nearly 10,000 MarTech companies or solutions. So there's been a lot of growth in this space, and it's accelerated. The challenge is property management specifically doesn't really get to use many of these tools because of the data gating that Janet was bringing up in a prior session. And they just don't connect. So let's quickly do a reverse and say, where did Fiona come from? Well, when we first started, this is the oldest screenshot of Fiona I could find. And I'm sad because I wanted to find the really ugly version of Fiona that was like a month prior to this. But Fiona was just it was a predictive platform for budgeting. And so essentially it basically chose your platforms and recommended a budget. I thought I'd show this photo that I thought, Erica, thank you, Erica, that you have your camera on, because this is how old it was. Reed had a good head of hair and I did not have enough money to get my hair cut. So I had to buzz it myself and it was terrible. And Nicole said never again. So I since go to the barber. I also thought this was a fun screenshot. This is from our second office space. It was a shared space, but we actually couldn't afford dry erase boards back then. So I had bought these like laminated boards basically from Home Depot, but we couldn't hang them on the wall because it was a shared space. So we would just carry this giant laminated board that we used as a dry erase board. So anyways, this is the original mock-up for Fiona. For those that have this on a big screen, you'll see it says Kazowie when you ask it to do something. So personally, I'd like to bring back the Kazowie button. We'll see if that gets passed by Kyle. All right, the problem we had with Fiona though was, ignore this first line, was that Fiona only predicted budgets. Clients would come to Fiona and we would preach you should be changing your budget each month or at least every quarter, but they often would use Fiona and just set it and forget it. It wasn't connected directly to the property management systems. And then Fiona became just one more platform that people had to log into. This worked well for consultants, but not for marketing directors that already have to jump into three or four different platforms. So there's a lot of friction with them adding Fiona into their workflow. Okay, let's move on to, so that's a little bit of the past and the friction we found and why, where we're going with the MOS. So we'll talk about that. So when you think about a marketing operating system or back to that tech stack I was talking at the beginning with the four quadrants, this is how we've broken it out. So there's the marketing budget and strategy. There's the marketing management and activation. There's marketing data and analytics and compliance and risk. Underneath each of these columns, those pillars, there are different features and tools that we've been working on. So we have everything in green are things that we've released, whether it be internally or externally. Everything is in yellow are things that we're working on now. And then everything in white are things that we want to get to, but we just haven't written. There's been no code written yet. I'm going to specifically talk about three things that fall into this column and show you guys some screenshots on the marketing data analytics side. So this is a quick mock-up of just what I mean when I put that slide earlier that all marketing should begin and end in one place. It doesn't have to be Fiona, but we just don't see anybody else doing it right now. But you should take all of your data sources. You should then push those into an agnostic data management platform. I mean, BigQuery is one option, as they were just mentioning on the analytics session. From there, you should be able to take your data and activate it or use it in different ways with best-in-class things. So we believe it shouldn't be just one platform where it's like, well, you're on property management system X and you have to only use their stuff. It should be able to use best-in-class, you know, anything. So that would be things like reporting and predictive analytics, budget planning, optimizations. I think things like YieldStar should be connected as well because marketing impacts pricing and vice versa. You should be able to send and pull data from other platforms as well. So we had BetterBot on earlier. You should be able to like pull data from BetterBot, but also if there's anything that'd be valuable to send to BetterBot, that should happen as well. proactive alerts for any of these data sources. And then, you know, task and vendor management also would be important there. So when we talk about one place for marketing begin and end, this is the way we're thinking about it. So near term, I want to focus on those three things in that data column that I talked about, what we're doing with reporting analytics, campaign optimizer, that's more of an internal tool, but how it will affect you guys, and then attribution. I just thought these are things that you guys might find interesting, even though there's a lot of probably highlights in that matrix that you'd enjoy. So first off, for reporting analytics, I'm going to skip through some of these quickly, but you should be able to bring all your data together and unify it and clean it into one place where it's all a common schema. You should then be able to grab business intelligence and have an interactive dashboard where you can drill into things and really look at your business in a 360 degree view. So it's not just like clicks in paid search or, you know, whatever on social, and then separately you have all your property management data. And then you should have a one-stop shop for all of that so that a marketer or operator doesn't have to go into like four or five different systems. This is the vision today when it comes to marketing. As many folks know, we've had a really great relationship with NinjaCat. Most folks in the space are actually using NinjaCat for their agency business or services business. So that includes like, I don't know, Rent, Entrata, WPromote, us. I know G5 had done it for a while. So almost everybody uses NinjaCat. They're really the best in class when it comes to marketing reporting. It brings in and it looks historically at campaign performance and lead performance. The issue is it doesn't bring in things like Entrata, Yardi, RealPage, like all of that data, it doesn't pull together. And it also isn't diagnostic or predictive. So we have these two bubbles in our development and it's in testing right now where it's pulling in data from all of your different systems and then visualizing it for us to dive in and do more analytics on. If that goes well, we'll be exposing that to customers sometime early next year. And then moving forward, it'd be moving into the more prescriptive side of things. So now taking all your data together across all of your providers, looking at and making recommendations on budget and campaign optimizations, and then eventually working on further on attribution. So here's how we're looking at internally for key advantages is we're thinking we can now unify all that data, we can make it interactive, and then we can pull it into one place. And so we're doing this to make ourselves more efficient as a service company, but then as we build it for ourselves, there's a lot of clients that we know that also would love, you know, all of this data in one place. So it's taking us a long time to get to this point where we are building all this infrastructure that you guys can't see. But then we'll be exposing it to you sometime next year where you guys can start to pull all your business intelligence together, visualize it, do what you want, but then also hopefully move that into other places too or integrate more seamlessly with different providers or vendors that maybe don't have all those connections completed yet. So just a screenshot of the business intelligence. So it should be drillable so you could pull by management company or by region or by, you know, whatever tag that you want on that property. It should be able to look at all the data. So from like your close rate from your CRM to your, you know, response rate to your pricing to your availability by units. You should have KPI based alerting so that you can say, hey, if this property's trend drops below 90, shoot me an email, what have you, or something like that. It should have row level security so that you can block different people from viewing things that they shouldn't be able to view, but or like if you're sharing with another provider, maybe you don't want them to see your whole portfolio, you just want to see part of it. And then obviously there should be, you know, some self-serve analytics options for power users. And one-stop shop for us, this means like that whole MOS. So like embed your business intelligence, your alerting, include tasks. So if like an alert goes off that, I don't know, campaign performance has dropped below Y, you should be able to send that to a vendor and say, hey, vendor, what the heck? Go look at that. We do believe in the future, we want to add our natural language generation to this so that it can tell you the so what behind all that data. So you don't have to like be your own business analyst, but so basically you should get the answers quickly. The system should alert you to that. But then if you're a power user, you can drill down and do some more of your own investigation if you want, and so on and so forth for some of this other stuff. as far as roadmap, we've been really spending this year on data management and BI development. So we did some internal dashboard releases in Q1. We really spent a lot of time on the semantic layer and the data model in Q2. We are working on some other dashboard, internal dashboard releases, like pulling in, making the integrations we need and pulling those into that system. And they're running it through a power user group now for testing purposes. Then as we move into Q1 and then the rest of 23, it's working on the alerting system specifically. I think that is super exciting internally, but also hopefully externally for folks. And then some cross-platform optimizations and then adding some NLG in there also. So again, so descriptor so that it does the analysis for you so that you don't have to look at all these charts and graphs, even though they look cool, but you know, you don't want to spend an hour, you know, researching. So that's reporting. As you guys have questions, if you can drop them in the chat and then I'll hopefully come back around, but I know I'm on a quick tight time limit here. So next is our campaign optimizer. So now that we're pulling all this stuff into one place, many folks that work with us know that we already, you know, adjust our campaigns on that dynamically. So add your pricing into your search ads, or like turn off one bedroom campaigns if you run out of one bedrooms and so on and so forth. But this is like a continued extension of that. So for us internally, this means that we're hoping that we can reduce our FTE count by 90% by automating things that humans are not, we don't get the best ROI out of. So doing account builds, pacing, and things like that doesn't really, you don't get the value out of a human for that. Where you get a human value is more on like looking and running strategic tests and optimizations and things like that. Basic optimizations as well are going to be automated, creative updates and things, so on and so forth. All this means at the end of the day for the customers that you guys should see an increased conversion rate, decreased cost per lead, faster campaign launches, and then being able to know that your PMS data is getting used cross-platform on your campaigns. This, again, I told you guys, I just put something up here that made me look super smart. So thank you, Lurch, for making this. But this is just showing that we're pulling all the data together from a lot of different sources. We're putting it through our own internal pipeline that cleans it and unifies the schema, as I mentioned. There's some machine learning put on that. Then we can use that for activation. So different scripts that will run to automate optimizations across the different ad channels. In addition, all the data that goes into the Eisenhower pipeline ends up going into our embedded analytics platform, which ends up generating that natural language that will come, you know, sometime in 23, the alerts and so on and so forth. As far as the roadmap for Ad Optimizer, it was internally being called Ad Optimizer, but we're playing around with different names. This is real, as I mentioned, more internal facing than external for you guys. But we have our MVP complete, and that's running now. Phase two, which is in work, is automated services for partners. We have a lot of partners that want to white label our services, but you know, there's just a way we want to go about that differently than we would treat a client that comes directly to us. Also account builds and specifically alerts. I think this is what's going to make the biggest difference internally and externally for clients. Phase three is working on more business rule optimizations and performance feedback loop, and then more machine learning optimizations in four. And then in five, start working on the multi-touch attribution model that we've concepted but haven't gotten to. All right, so that's the automation on campaign optimizations, then attribution. So today, us and many other companies have been using call tracking and analytics that we then push into Google Ads. I think you'll see more in our reporting session coming up in a bit about how our call tracking is different than the other providers. And so it works with Google Ads more intimately than other options do. But we do lead forecasting on that, and we do assisted channel attribution. Early in 23, we're going to be working on our media mix modeling with, I don't even want to try to pronounce this, Erica Bayesian. I don't know, that's close enough. This is the model that the DNA team wants to test for attribution and just to improve our media mix. And then start working more, like pulling in more of the ILS data and offline data to show how that should impact your media mix. Because right now we don't do a great job, anybody, frankly, of like pulling in your offline traffic and then saying, how should that adjust how much you're spending online? And then the future is to work, you know, considering data privacy concerns and security on a multi-touch attribution model that you know, that it'll never be fully solved because of all these privacy things that are going on, but we have an idea about how to get way closer and way more specific. Okay, so today we track conversions from phone calls and websites, and we integrate with the different providers that you may be using that may fire off different conversions. So for example, even I mentioned BetterBot earlier, I don't have that graphic up on here, but just about anything that's on your website, we can integrate with, and we can use that and pull that into our goals and events for optimization purposes. In the future, we're going to take all those events that were mentioned in GA4 and then different data from the PMS systems, and then clean it, unify it, do the identity graph, move into our data lake, and then run both analytics for you guys, but also the ad optimization and placement. So some of this may feel repetitive, but that's kind of the point, is we want to pull all the data into one place, unify it, and then be able to activate that data to run different things, whether it be optimizations, analytics, analysis, things like that. So what we've worked on so far is we rolled out our own homegrown call tracking this year to all clients. We built a lead forecasting model, which we haven't shown. I think you might see some of that in the reporting session. Then in Q4 through Q2, we're going to work on this assisted channel conversion with CRM matchback, some media mix modeling, and then eventually work on the identity graph and multi-touch attribution. So where does this leave us? I know I threw a lot at you guys really quickly. I think I'm actually going to have time to answer questions. So as a reminder, our vision is in the future that all work should begin and end in one platform for marketing. That platform should be agnostic of what vendors or data providers you're using. You should be able to plug anything into that you want and build off of that. We spent a lot of time in 22 working on this data and analytics side of things. There's still feature enhancements to be made, but we're really close to rolling that out. And then you should see, hopefully, if all things go well in 23, you'll see more happening on this marketing management and activation front. So ways like the very simple thing to consider is you jump into your BI platform. So in this case, Fiona, you're able to set an alert saying, if this metric does X, then push something to me. And then from there, you should be able to forward that or send it or tag a vendor in it. Say, hey, vendor, looks like calls are down. What the heck? Like, go fix that. So that is the vision. I know I spent most of my time on the data analytics front. All right, so now let me get to any Q&A. Oh, there weren't questions. These are just prior. Thank you, Erica, for my throwback shout out. And Janet, I appreciate it. I was a youngster. My beard made me look a little bit older than I was, but I'm shaving it closer. I can't believe I got through that in time. Anybody have any feedback on that vision that I'm talking about? Do you agree or disagree with it? Or do you think I'm being a little altruistic? Tell us more about the lead forecaster. Sure. So Fiona does predictive analytics now to tell you how much to spend. What we weren't exposing previously, but this is what the lead forecaster does, is pull down your guest cards from your property management system, analyze what channel those are coming from, forecast against your rent roll, and say, here's how many leads you are going to need in November, for example, to close the gap on occupancy. And to get that many leads in November, you now need to spend X. So this is all data mostly that Fiona was using in the background to make her recommendation. But for those power users, that's how this was concepted for. So some folks want to see, how many leads am I going to get from that spend? How many leads do I need at that time of year to get X done? What channels should I be spending on? That's what that does. Yeah, it gets heads in beds, Erica. Thank you. So when I first talked about this MOS concept with Robert from BetterBot, I talked with Robert from Highly, I talked with Scott from Perk, all these folks, they all were like, this is great. Yes, everything does need to come into one place. But they were like, good luck making it happen. And I understand. So that's why I was wondering if anybody had any feedback that they thought I was being a little bit overreaching with the vision. But our thought process here is, we have to pull all this data in for ourselves anyways. So we might as well then hopefully open it up for other providers. We'll see how that goes. Maybe we'll get our hands slapped as we go through that process. But I think we have a shot. All right. Erica, you had me so nervous that I wasn't going to have time that I flew through, and now we have extra time. Should we just kick it back to Jan, give everybody a bathroom break, or what do you want to do? She's nodding.
Yeah, we could do that.
All right, Jan, I will. Sure. I can organize the next folks together and get them in here, swap them out.
All right. In that case, we'll do a really quick breakout room. Although I also have a little activity. Maybe we can actually continue our escape room and for a few minutes.
Okay, cool. I'll get folks in here.
And while you get everyone set up, I'm going to share my screen again, and maybe we can complete our other few locks that are still open. We still have 5 to go. So let's see who still has some mental energy left to solve some of these next clues. Ooh, a math one. Who here was good at math? What is 6 divided by half? See if anybody's still here. And anybody who's good at math. If not, we'll have to ask our next speakers to solve this riddle for us. Is it? I think I'm just gonna solve it myself. See if anybody is willing to play the non-math ones. Maybe it's just math that was tricky. What is a butterfly to a Peruvian? Let's see if anybody has some suggestions, some clues, some guesses. Of course, you can also ask Google. There, mariposa. Erica, do you speak Spanish? Very good. Ooh, how old are you? What is the correct answer? Let's see who has a guess in the chat. Talk about why video is important to add to your media mix. 21, forever 29. Ooh, I like the forever 29. Let's try that. It is correct. Although I think the 21 would have been correct too. What is the answer to life, the universe, and everything? I think I know this one. If you have read the book or seen the movie, Scotch? Well, let's try it. It's not Scotch. What is the correct answer? The answer to life, the universe, and everything. Wine? It is not wine either. Is it happiness? No, it's not happiness either. I'm going to give you a clue. It is a number. And if you don't know the reference to this movie or book, then you're probably not gonna find it. But you're all sitting in front of the computer, so you're welcome to use Google. Because I'm sure Google would know the answer to life, the universe, and everything. So I'm gonna type in, ooh, Google tells you, Erica, the answer is 42. You are correct. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy is the book where they talk about this being the answer. Name one of the first three US presidents. That should be easy. One of the first three. George, whoops. Washington. Oh, did I spell it wrong? Maybe, there we go, just Washington. There we go. Good job, everyone. We solved all the riddles before our time was up. And I'm just looking at the studio. I think I see, are we ready to go? You're waiting for one more? All right. Well, I do have one other thing that I would love to do. So maybe we'll give you another. No, sorry. Did you say you're waiting for one more or you need one more minute? I can't hear you that clearly. Oh, now it's getting better. I think you have to put the mic a little bit closer. All right, are we ready to go or do we need another minute? Okay, I'm getting the thumbs up. All right. If you want to start sharing your slides and then we can get started. All right, we see it. The sound, like it sounds a little bit garbled on my end. I don't know if that's the same for anyone else. Your audio, yeah, the audio seems a little bit off. Okay, well.
Is that better? Is it still better?
I'm not sure if I can hear you yet. It still sounds very quiet.
All right, Jan, is that any better?
Ooh, there we go.
Oh, cool.
Now I can hear you loud and clear.
All right. Okay, cool. Awesome. All right. Well, let's
perfect.
Take that around too. So welcome everyone to our video presentation, the most important new addition to your media mix. So I am Caitlin. I am a social media strategist here at Digible, and I will introduce the lovely Kelsey.
Thank you. I am Kelsey. I'm one of the SEO analysts here at Digible, and we're here to talk to you about video and not microphone maintenance, because clearly we are not able to talk about that.
It's not our area of expertise.
Nope.
Thank you, David, for your tech help on that. Mm-hmm. Alrighty, so let's get into it. So what are we going to talk about today? We've got quite a few things on the agenda, but all exciting. So first, we're just going to get into kind of why video, what video can do for you, and then specific opportunities, how to measure impact once you've got video integrated into your matrix. Then how to use video across different platforms, so all types of cross-platform posting options, some audience analysis, best practices, and then the big budget question, budget, and then just some takeaways, and we'll jump into Q&A. I know video is a super broad topic, so we are going to do our best to weave you through this journey. So let's get into it. So let's talk about what video can do for you and for your properties. So first and foremost, I wanted to just kick into a quick video that we put together by the numbers. So let's see.
So what's a video presentation without at least one video?
Precisely. I figured for everything that we were going to say, like this. Alrighty, so there we have it. So big shout out to Tatiana for helping us to put that video together. So I just wanted to quickly hit on some of the big impact numbers that come out of that video. So talking about that 157% increase in SERPs is, that cannot be understated more. It's really just an incredible impact that these numbers can have when you're integrating video across platforms. Also talking about how there is a massive percent difference in how we process words and still images versus how we process video as like all humans. So the impact of video is not only just like an increase in your engagement rates, but generally an increase in how connected people are to your data, how much they're remembering the name of your property, things like that. So some really huge metrics that we can get into, and we'll dive in a little farther about impact. So, oops, my bad. So let's talk about what opportunities video can provide. So on the organic social side, you can really get in depth about your property, talk about your amenities, your floor plans, your community, your local areas of interest. You can really let people see firsthand what it's like to live in your community. And in a way that still imagery, carousel posts, really any other type of posting doesn't offer that same depth of perspective. Also talking about increased engagement across platforms. Video has been proven statistically over time, honestly, since its introduction into the social realm, to have significantly higher engagement rates across platforms. And same being that you can use video across platforms. You can film once and use it on 5, 6, 7 different platforms and see that increased engagement on all sides. You also have that higher potential for conversion and a possible potential for increased click-through rates to your website. So the likelihood of someone, you know, watching a tour video and going onto your website to learn more, significantly higher than someone seeing a singular floor plan image and doing that same click. So Kelsey, do you want to touch a little bit on the SEO side of things?
Oh, of course, always want to. So when you add videos to your marketing mix, it helps with SEO in a variety of ways, but for the main portion of what we're going to be talking about is it'll help you boost your organic traffic to your site, which is a ranking for Google, which I'll touch on in the next slide. But it also helps increase your user experience. So just promoting it to just offer more to people on your website so they can see the videos of your floor plans, your amenities, the neighborhood around the apartment complex in your community. And it just helps provide more information to people when they come to your website, which then can lead to increased time on your site, which again is another ranking factor for Google. So the longer you can keep people on your website, the better it's just going to be for everyone, especially for you, which then can lead to an increase in conversions. So the more high quality video content you can put on your website will help people have a better understanding of your property. And then, you know, maybe they'll schedule a tour, maybe they'll call your leasing office, you know, all the conversions that are important to you. And then you can also help generate more social shares, which then brings more people back to your website, because if they share a video on their Facebook, their friends see it, they'll go to your website, and it just creates like a beautiful loop of SEO.
Love the SEO loop. Awesome. My bad.
So we can touch a little bit more into the benefits of adding video to SEO and to your organic social, and just the impact that it can have. So
we'll jump into SEO first. Take it away.
So when you add SEO to your video mix or just your marketing mix, I can, like I said, boost organic traffic, which is a Google ranking factor. So the more incoming traffic you have, it's better for your SEO. So the more content you create, the more traffic you'll draw, and you'll just, you know, potentially rank higher and get more people to your website. It definitely also helps increase your user experience. So videos encourage people to spend time on your website. It gives people something to look at. They'll, you know, they won't click away super fast. which then sends more positive signals to search engines about your content, which again, boosts your SEO, which then hopefully increases your conversions, which is basically like, you know, what we all want. It keeps people engaged and it may help them schedule a tour on your property. But I think the biggest benefit, and this is across the board for like any product you use, is it helps you stand out from competitors in your area, especially if it's a high competition area. Adding those videos to your website and on your social media pages just helps you stand out, and people will you know, remember your amenities over someone else's because they're able to see it in such a visually appealing way.
Mm-hmm. And it really helps in just that it's also super underutilized in the multifamily market mm-hmm. overall. So there's really a big cutting edge that you can create there.
So when you are looking at videos on your website, here are some metrics that you can look at to make sure that it's the videos that you're putting out there are impactful. So on your website, you can look at the amount of video plays, video completion, average video play time, session duration, and social sharing. And you can use tools like, you know, Google Analytics, Google Search Console, and Google Tag Manager as free tools to help you determine what those metrics are. And if you add those videos to your Google Business Profile, which I will always encourage because that is just a beautiful way to get people engaged into your property early on, you can look at video plays, video completion, and average video play time there.
And it really does just add something to that GVP. It mm-hmm. shines it up. So let's talk a little bit more about organic social. So you've got some fantastic audience engagement opportunities across platforms. So you really have the opportunity to get personal with your audience. Talk about what are they interested in seeing in your property. Talk about your local community. Highlight local businesses. Just take a walk around your community and film it. And you really have this opportunity to increase those engagement rates. But interestingly, on organic social, which isn't typically conversion focused, there is a correlation between that increase in engagement and those informative videos and conversions. So being able to talk about, here's our amenities, here's our floor plans, here's our pricing, can speed up that apartment search process and answer questions that prospects might have long before they ever get to your website. Just makes that renting decision or that decision to at least become a lead, ask for more interest, quicker and easier. So that potential to increase those conversion rates, but also make them faster is a really exciting aspect of video on organic shows on organic social. And then talking a little bit more about that increased potential for click-through rates for tours. So there's also some statistics behind getting people onto those website landing pages, looking at tours, tour videos, floor plan videos, especially when they're well done or they're high quality or they feel very genuine. Do a lot to help people drive or to help drive people to your website. And that gets more into just making sure that you're in when you are making videos, including those call to action buttons, especially schedule your tour today, something like that. They perform super well. So let's talk about how to measure success. So video metrics, especially on organic social, to be 100% transparent, are a little crazy. But we can break it down. Every social media platform measures video impact and video success a little bit differently. But there's a few main areas that you can kind of focus in. One is view count. It's essentially just views. You would think of it in the classic sense. Interestingly, across platforms, views are counted differently. So for example, on Facebook, a view is only counted if it was viewed longer than 3 seconds. On Instagram, a view is counted if it was seen at all. There's no measured amount of time. On LinkedIn, it's viewed after 5 seconds. It counts as a view. So things change a little bit differently, but ultimately you're going to want to look at how many people are viewing your video. Then getting into engagement, how many people are liking, commenting, sharing. This is one of the true magic parts of video is how much personal engagement you can bring. You can pose questions. You can ask polls. You can integrate those opportunities for engagement in your videos in a really fun, but also really simple way. And then talking about watch time. So what's the average amount of time that someone's staying on the video? Let's say you've posted a 45-second floor plan walkthrough video. Are you losing people after 15 seconds? Are you losing people after 30 seconds? Are they watching all the way through? It's a really great insight into how much time people are spending on the video and how you can improve the videos over time on those higher engaging sections. And then getting again into click-through rates. So your number of clicks divided by your number of views, how many people are actually following through from that video, headed to your website, making a call, taking some sort of action. I also briefly wanted to touch on when you're looking at specific videos that are posted on your website, I know it's not necessarily organic social, but keeping in mind that average session duration can also increase. So if there's a video on your website, someone is likely to stay on that website page for longer, and that's a great metric to look at for success. So keeping in mind that the goal of video on organic social overall is to grow your brand, engage your audience, but you may see those increased click-through rates and conversions as well, which is really exciting. So talking about the underused market, video is not used for widely in the multifamily industry at all at the moment. So there's a really fantastic opportunity here. But noting video is also not as widely posted overall as it should be when correlated to how much engagement it's getting. So this chart is specifically talking about Instagram, but the red and blue little bars are video content versus the green and orange are like still image or carousel content. So the amount of content being posted is still leaning towards still image and carousel image, but the amount of engagement that's coming in is strongly leaning towards that video content. So making the transition from using stills to using more video content can be really beneficial, and you can really see an increase in that engagement. So that all being said, you can do this across platforms. I really hope that y'all love this gift. I had so much fun making it. You can be efficient with your time. Video does not have to be something that takes triple the amount of time that having an image library does. You can create evergreen content that works regardless of the season, regardless of the platform. You can also take one video, splice it differently, and put it together to make four different videos. Essentially, one piece of well-made content or one, you know, section of filming can work for Facebook, it can work for Instagram, it can work for TikTok, LinkedIn, Twitter, your paid ads, your SEO, and your website. So you can be efficient with the way that you film, really get the most bang for your buck, really be the most useful with your time, but still see those massive gains in engagement. So none of that is relevant unless you know who you're talking to. So Kelsey, let's get a little bit into audience.
Right, let's do it. Especially because we had Oprah on the last side, I think it's just only fair that I just point out that Oprah knew her audience, love free stuff. So you should know your audience when you make videos. So luckily for us, NAA posted a study on their website that RealPage did a survey of all the renters in the US market, and they broke them down into eight distinct types. We don't have the time to go over all eight, but we'll just talk about just the largest three just so you guys can get an idea. So the first group and the largest are the starting out singles, which make up 29% of today's market. They're typically the youngest, around 26 years old, and they move around a bit, you know, whether that be because of rising prices or just they're like looking to find a new area where they find themselves, where they fit. They tend to move around a bit, and they will go for smaller apartments just based off of, like, you know, everyone. I think when we first got a new job, we weren't making a lot. So we're just trying to find a place where we can get the most for our money, for our the most bang for our buck. Yes. I tried to say that like 10 times earlier today, but
money for our dollar, something like that.
We all get it. The next group is very similar to the starting out singles, which are the young adult roommates. They make up 21% of the US market. They're around 28, but the difference between them and the starting out singles is that they have two or more adults that they live with. So they take advantage of that combined income, and they're able to afford the pricier units because they have the dual incomes coming in. And the third group we'll talk about, which is often the most overlooked household, is the perma renters at 16% of the market. These residents on average are around like in their early 30s, they're single. But an important thing to note is that they always renew their expiring leases at least once. So when you're making content, you can kind of keep these groups in mind, so that way your videos are being seen. Because the more eyes on your videos, the more engagement you'll get, the more people going back to your website and just converting. So all that said, when you guys are making your videos, keep in mind not who you want to see the videos, but where you can get the most eyes on your videos. So for the starting out singles, they're, you know, in the 26-year age group. You can post your videos onto Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, because that's, you know, primarily what the apps that they use. I would suggest, though, posting videos on all platforms, just because it gives you a better idea of the engagement value on each of those platforms. And then you can kind of pull away from certain platforms if they're just not benefiting you. So that's just a great tool for when you're planning your marketing strategy, just to keep those groups in mind, and also just kind of give you ideas for content to create in case you get stuck.
Yeah, exactly. You can really start and like adapt into the TikTok for like a specific kind of demographic range, or like, and just appeal to different audiences, but using the same video and just kind of like tweaking little things across platforms can really make a huge difference.
And of course, being the SEO analyst that I am, I would encourage you to post videos onto your Google Business profile, because that's primarily where a lot of people start their search for apartments. They don't know, you know, all the apartments in the area. So when they, you know, Google apartments in Denver, the more information you can provide to users online, just the more you'll stand out and the better chance you'll have of people, you know, going to your website or your property for a tour. And then also posting videos onto your property website, just to keep people engaged there as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's get into how to actually execute video for your property and talk about some best practices. So a really interesting thing when thinking about video is the discussion of sound. A lot of videos, most people I think on TikTok watch their videos with sound. It's very common to play things with sound, or like with sound and caption. But interestingly, on Facebook, at least over 75% of videos are played completely on mute. So being able to film in a way where you might have someone speaking through the video, but if you also include captions or include a voiceover or something like that, making sure that things are adaptable both with and with sound is super important. And it's also going to allow you that flexibility to post across platforms and still have that effective engagement. Yeah, and then just really considering adding those captions in. It doesn't necessarily have to be like word for word captions. You can do like blurb pop-ups on certain things as well, and play around with that to see what gets you the best results. Optimizing your video assets is super important. This can get tricky sometimes with the balance between compressing a video size without losing quality. Oftentimes there's a happy middle ground that you can find. And then saving everything in MP4 format is going to, again, give you the best cross-platform flexibility. This one might seem a little bit obvious, but I think it's important to say, don't steal content. It's very easy to grab stock footage or grab photos or things about your local community, especially, that do require a certain level of attribution. It's not to say that you can't use them, but make sure that you're attributing things correctly. This also definitely goes for music. TikTok, Facebook, Instagram all have free music libraries that you can tap into. But especially if you have a specific thing in mind, make sure that you have the correct attribution and copyright rights that are required for that, just so you don't get into anything sticky. Showcasing your entire community. Video can be so much more than just a floor plan walkthrough. You can tour your pool, do a workout in your gym, show off your beautiful lobby. If you have drone footage that you want to use and show where you're located in your community, or if you have a beautiful skyline view, use video to help you show that off. The options are genuinely endless, and it's really fun to get the chance to kind of be creative with it. And then always just remembering fair housing guidelines. This is key, especially if you are captioning or doing a voiceover or anything like that, making sure that you are using inclusive and diverse language. Avoid mentioning anything about age, ability, keeping in mind something like walk-in closets versus spacious storage, something being steps away from an apartment versus moments away. It's small changes, but those are really key. And sometimes it's easy to forget when you're filming. So for organic social specifically, it's really important to pay attention to your lighting, your sound, your focus, your framing. You can definitely keep it simple, but those are kind of going to be the key aspects to really getting a quality video content. You can also really play around with perspective. So you can try filming vertically, try filming in square format, try filming in horizontal format, play around with cutting those together and see what happens. Vertical is what I would recommend to start out. It's going to give you the most cross-platform functionality, but you can really play around with, if you want to get kind of lower to the ground, stand on a chair, play around with those perspectives, bring the camera actually all the way up to your eye level. Those can make big differences in the way that your videos appear and the engagement level that they have. If you're editing, again, just paying attention to that copyrighted music, proofread your captions. It's the small things that really show the quality. And then test run, watch your video from the perspective of a potential renter, but also watch your video from the perspective of a current resident. If you're showing off your pool, but recently there was like some resident complaints about the pool or something like that, just keeping those like perspectives in mind can really help bring you some success on the video. And then on the SEO side, there's some more specifics as well.
Yes. So I wouldn't say there's too many differences between creating a video for SEO versus organic social. It definitely has a lot of all the same best practices, but where SEO comes into play would be at the very beginning when you're trying to find helpful keywords to target, because that's kind of like your roadmap for when you're creating videos. If you just kind of go in blind, not really knowing what you want to do, people can tell. So definitely starting out with like research about what keywords are being searched for the most. You know, if you want to make a video about how to design or like utilize a space in like a studio apartment, you know, make sure that those keywords are something that people are looking for. And then on the back end, like once you have the video edited and you're test running it and it looks great, SEO is going to, you know, be your savior in getting people to look at your video and getting eyes on it. Because using the keywords that you found, you want to add that to your metadata. So adding it to your title tags, your meta description, just so search engines are able to understand what that video is about to give it more context and so people can find it. And you also want to include a video transcript, again, just for search engines to be able to crawl that content, find those keywords, and have a better understanding of what your content is about. You also want to add subtitles because not only is it helpful to remain, in order to remain ADA compliant, but it also just allows everyone to be able to see your video. Because I don't know if anyone like online is listening that is a culprit of this or like a criminal of this, but no one likes to listen to people play videos out loud, like on full volume. So you wanna add subtitles to your videos, that way people who are in public places with distracting noises are able to still understand your content while reading the subtitles in the video. Because there's nothing worse than someone who plays a video at full volume, like in the library without headphones on. So don't be that person. And I'm so sorry if I just outed somebody that is that person, but I think it's about time we address it and just let it be known that it's not okay. You also want to include CTAs in your video. So whether it's like a video of like where you're verbally communicating something, like a tour of an apartment, make sure you include like, hey, schedule a tour with us, like visit our website, but also add links and those commands like in the description of the video as well, just so you can give people a goal of like what they should be doing once they see your video to help lead to those conversions. And if you're going to compress a video for your website, please do so, because it just helps to keep the page speed faster, because that is a Google ranking factor. So the slower your page loads because of that large video is going to affect your rankings. And I think one more thing that's super important is depending on what your goal is. So if you want videos to rank on Google or optimize it for YouTube, you want to make sure that you're not embedding the same video on your website multiple times, because if that video is in relation to like a blog post about something to help add more value, don't post that video like on your floor plans page, for instance, because those videos will compete against each other, and you're pretty much just doing extra work for no reason.
Yeah, competing against yourself. And we obviously want to get the most like bang for our buck with how we're posting, but also really rank as well as we possibly can, 100%. So big question. I feel like for a lot of people, video shoot equals money. So let's talk about how we can circumvent that. We know that budgets are tight. I really hope you guys are admiring these gifts. They were so fun. So video does not have to break the bank. It is very DIYable. So Abby talked a little bit in her TikTok presentation from earlier today about how to film on a budget. And smartphones have an incredible capability, super strong cameras. So just filming with a phone is fantastic. I think the only tips that I would have is like, do your best to kind of minimize like shakiness. A tripod can really help with stability, filming on top of a table, just finding somebody who's got a really steady arm, whatever it is that's going to work out for you, that's going to help. And then really getting into trying those multiple angles, try perspective, start off from the corner of the room so you see the full space. And then I think one of the biggest things that video really adds up as far as cost is lighting. Lighting kits are super pricey. We definitely get that, but we have this wonderful thing called the sun that we can utilize. So, but if you have a west-facing unit, try filming during that sunset golden hour time. If you have something that faces east or doesn't have the best lighting ever, try that morning light and get that kind of softer white light. Use that to your advantage and take in the natural light. If you're filming outside, try midday and play around with when does your pool or when does your gym or when does your lobby look the best. Make use of transitions, cuts, captions. Play around with splicing videos. Like I said earlier, you can get a lot out of one video with interesting and different transitions. And then iMovie and other in-app editing is your friend. iMovie is simple. It might seem intimidating, but it doesn't have to be. So making those cuts, adding in those captions can be really simple. And speaking of simple, keep it simple. Videos do not have to be complex. It does not have to be a Michael Bay movie. There does not have to be like 97 special effects. Show off the one thing you want to show off, get your call to action in there and see how it does. So is video here to stay? Yeah. What's the long-term strategy? So creating a film schedule is important. So setting clear expectations about who is filming, when do we want them to film? This can be your on-site team. This can be someone that you outside hire, a freelancer, someone in your who's living in your apartment community, like a live-in influencer, however you're choosing to go about filming, which is something that our Digible team can help you address, because I know that can be a concern. Creating a schedule and saying, this is when we're going to film. We're going to film once per quarter. We're going to film once per month. We're going to film once per week, if that's something that you're able to do. Obviously, the more content, the better, but I think keeping in mind, if you go into filming saying, well, we're going to film once, it's not going to be as effective as it could be if you are willing to film multiple times. So creating that schedule is important. And continuing to encourage creativity, have fun with it. And then ultimately, chat with your Digible team about how to integrate across platforms. We can help you wade through figuring out engagement rates and views and clicks across all of these different platforms. So
I know we threw a lot at you guys.
It was a lot, I know.
So here's the main takeaway, besides that we're the best. Video can provide an average of 157% increase in organic traffic from the SERPs. It can also lead to faster and higher conversions. You want to make sure that you're putting your videos in front of your focus audience, because what's content if no one sees it? And also when you're creating video content, it doesn't have to be expensive. There are so many ways that you can make an affordable video that's also just informative. You know, it's great looking. It's just visually appealing. There's ways to do it. And I think the biggest takeaway is that video is essential to your marketing strategy. Like Caitlin said in the beginning, not a lot of people are using video in multifamily right now. So this is your chance to really just jump on the trend and, you know, be a leader in the industry.
Yeah, absolutely. This is the moment to tap in. So we've included some resources and helpful links on this final slide, that how to film a TikTok video from earlier, beginner's guide to iMovie, some editing tips. But ultimately, our number one resource, or your number one resource, is us. So talk to us about your video questions, and we can help you figure it out. So I'm going to open it up to Q&A. Let me grab the chat here real quick. I know it's kind of been popping off, which is fantastic. So let's see. Oh, we've got some jokesters in here. I love it. All right. Oh, we're back to George Washington. Let me scroll down. Okay. So let's see. All right. We had some questions for Erica about SEO versus social as far as usefulness. I think that's actually a really good question. I think it's dependent on your goals for the property. I think it's a really great approach to start with both and see how things go. And kind of, I think, and also they also really complement each other. They kind of go hand in hand. So having that metadata on the back end with your SEO can really help those organic social posts do better, and vice versa. Let's see. Got some other questions in here. Let's see. Oh my gosh, David, with the, if you could only have one social platform, what would it be? Do you have a social platform, like love of your life?
I do, but it's not a video related one. I just love Reddit. I learned so much from it. There are some videos on it, but we didn't talk about it in this presentation.
Yeah,
so I don't know if that's a valid answer to the question.
That's fair. I feel like currently mine is TikTok. I just kind of can't get enough. I feel like I would hold on to that. And I also, in the multifamily sense, I also see a huge potential for value there. Were there any other questions in the chat? Anything we can talk about? Oh, I see one from Erica. Do you recommend alt text specifically for IG? That is a really good question. So I've seen mixed results as far as having it on there. I think it has potential, but I think there's definitely still some more like research and to be done. So I would say like we should try it, but I wouldn't say it's a recommendation. I think it could potentially be effective, but I don't think it has like a massive shift in results. So yeah. Oh, that's so awesome to hear. That is fantastic. A video team today. That is great. So, all right. I think we are just short on time. So I am going to go ahead and wrap up. But thank you all so much for tuning in. And if you have any other questions or about video, feel free to shoot us a chat.
Wait a second. You didn't answer my other one.
Oh, sorry. All right. Hold on. David called me out one
if
second.
If you were czar of one of the social platforms, what would you be?
Oh, my gosh. I missed it. I'm so sorry. A czar of one platform. Which would I pick?
I'm going to be that person. I honestly don't know what czar means. Like,
you just, you're like in total control.
The ruler.
Oh. Oh. I had that much power.
I'm afraid of what the face Kelsey just made. It?
I don't know. I feel like. You go first. I'm going to think about it.
Oh, I want to be the queen of Instagram. Oh, man. Okay. I don't know what it is about Instagram, but I just feel like that there's so many things that I would love to like change or like add into. If I had the power to tap into their API, I totally would. So I think that that would probably be.
And what change would you make for me? First change is queen.
Oh, my gosh. Changing how reels appear in feeds, it drives me a little crazy, like the way that they're formatted. And I feel like I would really want to switch that up. And
way to bring it back to video.
It's true. It genuinely, I know that it drives me crazy. It's not even a shameless plug. It just drives me nuts. I feel like I would change that. I also want to change the logo. I feel like it's like, I feel like it could be so much spicier and more fun. What about you, Cass? Are you still thinking?
Yeah, it's because there's so many possibilities. There's so many things that I just want to be like the czar of social media. Could I
all of
could
it?
I just
yeah, choose it.
Yes, I don't want to pick one. I want all of. I want all control. I want this to be a dictatorship.
Then total control. I love it.
All right, cool. Well, okay, thank you, cool. Guys.
Yeah, of course. Thank you so much.
Bye, everyone.
All right, big round of applause for our video session. And while we do a quick switch over in the studio, I actually looked up a couple of fun videos that are all about social. And there are these fun little animations, and I want you to guess which social media platform it is about. So while David is getting, I think it's Nicole and Kaylee ready, I'm curious if anybody can tell me as quickly as possible what logo is being created here. I hope you've found it already. Okay, Grace was kidding.
Grace, I thought that was a good
was
one.
Not LinkedIn, but we were just talking about the Instagram logo, so maybe this one up. Nice. I'll do one more because I see there's already two people sitting in front of the computer. Let's see if you can guess it before it's super obvious. Anybody get it? I hope so. Okay. I think Danuka, Pinterest, right. I think we're ready to come back to the studio. I'm just going to ask you to share your slides. And I think then we're ready
okay,
to
Jan?
Go. Yes, we can hear you.
There we are.
All right. Sorry, I'm just getting them shared. Oh. Hang on, there's one other change I gotta make. Sorry, guys.
There we go.
Perfect. All right, I think we're all set up. Well, we are the last session of the day. So if you're still with us, thanks for hanging in. Kaylee and I are here today to talk about reporting, one of our favorite topics. So we're gonna be diving into trends, data storytelling, and the future of multifamily reporting. We'll do quick intros. So let me flip this. Okay, perfect. So I'm Nicole Staley. I'm one of the co-founders here at Digible and then our chief experience officer. So I oversee the experience for our clients, our partners, and our employees. And reporting is near and dear to my heart. So I'm excited to be here with you today.
Awesome. I'm Kaylee. I'm a senior account manager here at Digible. I work with our clients as well as our client services reporting support team, as we call it, alongside a few awesome other team members. We work on third-party and in-house reporting initiatives, template creation, template support, as well as team education. So excited to be talking about all things reporting and multifamily today. So our agenda today really includes data storytelling and metric misconceptions. So that includes framework and best practices for strong data storytelling, industry metric misconceptions, as well as how to work with your agency on reporting, what to ask for and how to scale your data, delivering reporting to multiple stakeholders, including multifamily personas, and then the metrics that really matter to these personas. We'll also be walking through Digible's approach to reporting present state as well as future and how we're going to be unifying all the data that we provide.
Awesome. So let's jump into data storytelling. So first and foremost, what is data storytelling? When we think of data storytelling, it's really using complex multiple sets of data to visualize a narrative. So we're pulling in all those different data, we're using visuals, and we really want to provide the so what in a clear way that provides context. So think about what's happening at the property portfolio level and how is really this impacting our ROI that our marketing efforts have had. So we like to really make complex things super simple. So really telling a story with that data.
Awesome. So before telling that story, there's just a few questions to ask. So the first is, who is your audience? So for example, an owner probably wants to know how much I am spending on digital marketing and what's ROI, as well as how many leads am I getting and what is the impact of our occupancy and goals, where as a marketer probably wants to dive into some different metrics. So the second question we ask is, what story you're trying to tell? So once we've chosen that audience, what are those key KPIs that you want to focus on? The third is, what are our key takeaways and next steps? So reports should really influence action and they should be a jumping off point for your digital marketing strategy. So based on the data you're seeing, what do you need to adjust? Are there platforms you need to adjust, keep things the same, and tweak targeting?
So once you have the answers to those key questions and you know who you're talking to, the next thing to think about is, how are you going to lay out this data in a way that makes sense? So what's your framework? We love a good funnel. So we like to think about high level to secondary metrics, or really driving that user down and telling a story that way. So we're going to start with macro metrics. That's going to be anything that's big picture. So think, you know, how much am I spending? How many leads am I getting? What's the ROI? Any type of month over month trends here. So that's all going to be first and foremost, you should get that out on page one. From there, you're going to go into primary metrics. So that's thinking through, how did we get here? What are those supporting metrics that are driving those macro metrics? For that, it's going to be things like campaign performance. So impressions, clicks, click-through rate, anything that's helping you get to those leads and conversions. And then last but certainly not least is going to be your secondary metrics. And that's, what have we done? So that's going to be your nitty-gritty keyword performance, creative performance, what's helping you get to those impressions and clicks, which is ultimately helping you drive leads. So think about it in a way that you're, you know, outlining a story that you can take the user down this path with you. Some do's and don'ts here. So when we talk about data storytelling, we always like to have clear metrics. So do not data dump. We are guilty of this internally, where we'll just put a bunch of data on a spreadsheet and try to make sense out of it. That's not going to be the best way to receive information. So don't data dump, making sure you're focusing on metrics that do matter. So answering the question of what is the most important thing you're trying to tell. Always lead with ROI. So show our ROI first thing and foremost. That should be on the first page of your report. And then definitions are super important. So try to define what is a true conversion. We can think about conversions in so many different ways. Is it an actual form fill? Is it a phone call to the property? Is it just a click on this button? I think that's one of the most common misconceptions, is when you're just saying conversion, you're assuming that the other person knows what you're talking about when you're mentioning conversions. Next up, make sure to use consistent naming conventions, so that when you're flipping between reports, between property reports to a roll-up report, everything is super consistent. You're not confusing your user with the naming conventions you're using. And then we always merge channel data. So making sure that you are merging, if you're talking about Google Analytics, Google Ads, Facebook, merging that data into one to provide that top level metric is super important. And then something that I found super successful is providing a glossary. So defining every metric that you have on every single page.
Awesome. So when we're in that data storytelling, we really want to focus on quality over quantity. So a question that comes up is, how many leads did I get? And sometimes that's seen as how we measure success, but truly What has a greater impact on your property's goals is the quality of those leads. So it's best practice initially to really optimize campaigns for quality over quantity, and it's okay to show that on your report. So you can do this in many ways. Something we do here at Digible is showing the quality of calls versus the quantity. So we have that quantity. However, we dive even deeper into how many of those calls were quality, and that's what we focus on. Another thing you can also do is focus on full form submissions in Google Analytics versus button clicks. A lot of times tracking can get in the way of that. However, if you do have the ability to show full form submissions, do it, because that's going to really show you the quality of the leads that came through. Awesome. Visualizations. So visualizations, big word, are really your best friend when it comes to reporting and telling a true data story and providing an experience. So there's a few ways you can do this. You can use multiple different widgets, but it's important to be strategic with the widgets that you're choosing to use. So you can use line and bar charts specifically for a connected series of data. So that would be executive summaries. So let's say you have calls, website conversions, and form fills. That can be a great place to have your line and bar charts, or conversions over time, metric versus metric comparisons over time as well. You can combine bar and line charts specifically for comparing values in different categories. So we also do this with our call quality. So we can see total calls versus the quality of calls over a set series of time. Pie charts are great too. However, they're really great to show percentages at one specific set of time, not, let's say, year over year comparison date range data. Somewhere you can use this is really if you're doing a budget analysis on how much you spend on your marketing efforts or your platforms. Let's say you spent 30% in paid search, 20% in TikTok, et cetera, as well as time of day. Tables are great too, but take them with a grain of salt. You want to be careful with how you use tables. They're a great place to organize data. However, they can be a little intimidating at once. So it's a great place for a scorecard for important metrics, as well as slicing and dicing data, as well as a deep dive analysis. So once you've kind of structured your report and discovered this is what I want to show, this is how I want to show it, it's important to add specific colors to draw your audience in. Using brand colors and guidelines is really important to make sure you're consistent with your brand, as well as it draws your audience in. We also are very careful of color contrast. Although a lot of colors can look really pretty on a report, you want to be able to see the data, because the data is what's most important at the end of the day. You also want to be mindful of bold colors. Bold metrics. We recommend bolding your metrics because it's really an easy way for you to identify just important metrics instantly. Let's say this is a marketing manager who doesn't have a lot of time to pull and fully review a report in detail. Having those high-level conversions bolded are really nice to easily access that data. And then lastly, month over month and year over trends really help tell a story of how the data has changed and how seasonality has come into play, as well as what the future holds. And this next one is really important, so listen up. Don't use Comic Sans. Just don't do it. If you know, you know. It's not pretty, and it really doesn't provide a professional experience. So
I think this might be your biggest hot button. I'm going to start sending you all emails in Comic Sans.
I mean, if you send me an email in Comic Sans, unless you're Nicole, I might not.
Will not reply. Awesome. So next up, we're going to dive into some metric misconceptions. And this section is just kind of how to think about certain metrics a little bit differently. So first up, sorry, went too fast, is bounce rate. So no one come at us. We're not saying don't look at these metrics. We are just saying take the following metrics with a grain of salt. So important things to keep in mind when you're looking at bounce rate is that it's not going to tell the whole story. So things that it doesn't factor for are things like industry site widgets. So let's say a user comes to your homepage, they actually are starting to engage with a BetterBot widget on your site, they're filling out their information there, they might bounce and bounce rate might look super high, but it doesn't really take into account that that was actually a captured lead. So think about that of the experience of your website when you're looking at bounce rate. The other thing it doesn't really talk through is like how quickly the user was qualified. So maybe they did a Google search for one bedroom apartments in Denver and they landed right on that one bedroom floor plan and they called the property right away. That's a huge success. Bounce rate is still going to look high there. It also doesn't talk about why a user left your website, so you won't be able to gather that metric or that insight from that metric. And so what we always recommend is looking at bounce rate, but then also looking at the user flow in Google Analytics. So how are people engaging with different pages of your site? How are they navigating versus just how they're bouncing?
Awesome. Another one, click-through rate. Don't come at us for this one, but many, you know, marketers focus on click-through rate as the primary metric really for success for your campaign. It's very important, however, it's not that important, and it doesn't really paint a full picture of engagement. So there's deeper metrics you can really focus on. So conversion quality, you know, really outweighs how many users clicked on your ads and the frequency of those clicks. So we want to focus on what happens after the prospect clicks. So did they convert? How did they convert? Did they revisit the website or did they come in through a different channel? So we pulled a few platforms that we run here at Digible, and what we focus on instead of click-through rate, or actually in addition to click-through rate. So for paid search, we talked about quality versus quantity. We focus on that primarily versus click-through rate, as well as display, the post-click and post-view website conversion. So after your ad was seen, what happened next? And then same thing with paid social. Awesome. Another one, don't come at us. Average SERP position. So really, AKA, this is your average search position on Google, which has multiple factors that come into play with this metric. So this metric is really an average metric, and it's not an actual in the moment position on Google.